And they're all like that, they're going. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Rotary Reboot 2, a journey to a vibrant club. This is the production we were forced into making to provide a way for clubs to visualize how to turn their situation around with respect to improving membership and their club's vibrancy. This assembly will be different from others you've attended, not only because you are doing it as a live stream event, but also because you will be required to work. If you haven't had time to download the workbook that you were sent that accompanies this training session, I would suggest you do that right now. What you will experience over the next 3 hours is something that you have never experienced before in a Rotary training session. You're going to watch real Rotarians acting in parts developed from Rotarian archetypes as they experience adversity in a hypothetical club we have developed. We are certain you will see parts of your club in our fictional club. There will be 6 10-minute videos, each followed by a 15-minute discussion on the issues and potential actions the club will seek to implement. It is during these discussions that you will be Reboot 2, a journey to a vibrant club.
Got to you too, huh?
Yeah.
I told him he'd have to play the friend card to get me to be a membership director, but he did. What's your story?
Well, Bill, I know you had a tough first meeting with the club, but I started out by attending an amazing service project and noticed that it was the only one we did all year. Hmm. Something has to change, and I want to make it better. Hey. What? Sorry. In my business, if I'm not posting, I'm irrelevant. So, gotta keep to it. What's going on here? Hank told me if I came to this meeting that I'd be able to double my posts that I do each day.
I don't think that means what you think it means.
Hey, guys. Thanks for coming. I just got back from PETS. It was just and amazing, and I am fired up. So, Bill, as my membership chair, I listened to some really great past district governors there, and they had a great idea. If you can just get every member to bring in one more member, our membership problems are going to be solved. And Sarah, I know you want to do more projects. So here's what I want you to do. Remember last year when we did that project, we did that awning and then it fell down? I want you to go back out to those people and talk to them, and we're going to build it up right this time, and maybe it'll even stay up more than 1 year. And Jess, you're going to go take pictures of that and find out, you know, how bad it looks right now, and then you're going to take pictures when we get it all done, and we're going to let the community know we are doing great things. So are we all clear for the year?
Oh, don't look at me. I have a clear direction.
Okay, fine. I guess I'll say something. Dad, I mean, Hank, that wasn't what I meant when I said we needed to be doing more projects. Sure, we should fix the things that we messed up, but I spoke with the executive director for the facility, and she said that the awning was really low on her priority list. I think we should be asking what people want and then focusing on doing that and doing it right.
Honey, I mean Sarah. You know how Rotary works. The president picks the project and the club goes and does it.
Yeah, I remember you taking me to that project before I was a member of the club. Hey, by the way, thanks for paying my dues and telling me I had to join. No, but seriously, I think if we had more than, 5 of our 50 members at that project, Maybe that awning would still be standing today. And by the way, we have limited funds. How many times are we going to rebuild this thing and call it a community project?
Okay. I think we need to take a little break here. Hank, how do we communicate the things we do to the club?
Well, our newsletters, and I tell them at the meetings.
Ah, you mean the newsletter that we know that only 10% of our members even open and read? Isn't that right, Jess? And what else do we do?
Well, we sent around a sign-up sheet.
At our meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, so how many people do we have attending our meetings now that we don't have perfect attendance to worry about anymore?
Hank! For the past 2 years, our average has gone from 50 to 40%.
Stacy, were you eavesdropping again?
Well, I told you I would take minutes, but you said it wasn't important, so I guess I'll just go.
You should go. I'm hearing a lot of negativity here. I don't think I wanted to have it written down.
Okay. So 40%, that would be 20 people, and we know already that 12 of those 20 are the old guys that show up every week and sit at their two tables, and they haven't done any project work in a long time. So that leaves 8. So how many people signed up on the sign-up sheet there, Hank?
5.
I guess then that's pretty good. 5. Okay. 5. Well, I don't know where to go from there.
It's pretty bad. Did we bother to post it on our Facebook page or on the website or on the website calendar?
No, I don't think we've ever even invited someone who isn't a family member to one of our projects or posted about what we've done in the community.
No, right here. We actually did post something. That's the project. It's been there since I was a member. It's 4 years old. And there is a highlight here. Our collapsed awning. Yeah, that on social media, it got over 1,000 views.
Really?
Yeah, that's the image. That's the image.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, you know, if our fundraiser had done better that year, we could have hired someone who knew what they were doing and bought better materials.
Dad, we've been doing that crab feed since before I was born. Remember? Here's you holding me at 6 months old.
I remember that. It was wonderful.
Crab bib and you holding that big red solo cup.
Classy.
Man, those were the good old days. We could pack them in and we made thousands.
Yeah, so I've actually been to the crab feed. Well, I've worked the crab feed the last 3 years. And I can honestly say I don't think I've seen anyone who wasn't a member or a family member of a member at one of those events.
And it's just for that reason that we're going to have a real hard time raising the bar and raising any more money at our fundraiser.
So you guys are saying we need to do something new.
I mean, we've had some members that I think agree with you. Take Alan. I think he had a couple of ideas.
Hank.
Stacy.
Yes, I have Alan's ideas right here from the minutes from a board meeting that we had a year and a half ago. And then Alan suggested we do something, anything different to start bringing in the community and other people's money. And he even provided examples,
really?
Like virtual auctions, a beer fest, a wine event, a community food truck, and a carnival.
Okay, I get it. So he had some ideas.
Actually, there was 14 in total, and I can keep going.
That's okay. So why don't we just give Alan a call and bring him into the meeting?
You know, Hank, I'd love to, but he left the club 6 months ago. Do you want me to call him and ask him to rejoin?
I wondered why I hadn't seen him around. Why don't we tell our members when people leave?
Do we really want to let them know that they can leave?
Well, I'm assuming we did an exit interview.
Hank, that was before my time. But I can call them if you want. Hank, I know we don't need to remind you about this, but we've lost a lot of members in 8 of the last 10 years. I mean, the last time things were positive was when you brought Sarah in.
Man. The club did a lot better when we had more members and we could do more things. The good old days.
You say that a lot.
Hank, can I say
You know, Stace, with what I'm hearing, it's just a lot of negativity. I'm not even sure I want that to be written down. So thank you, but you can go.
Bye, guys. Hi, Stacey.
Hi, Stacey.
Hank, are we the only people that you've asked to be part of your leadership team this year?
Yeah. You know, at Pets, they gave us the, you know, what we needed. And to be honest, you guys were the three that I really had to have. And so you were kind enough to say yes when I volunteered you, and I really appreciate that. Oh, that reminds me. I do have one more thing that I've got to get ready. I got to get a president-elect. That's important.
Hank, I'll do it. I've been club secretary forever. Ever since I joined the club 10 years ago, I've been doing club secretary.
Stacy?
Yeah?
Like Fred, our treasurer, you are doomed to be secretary forever.
Doomed?
Take it as a compliment. You do a great job, just like Fred. Mm-hmm. Now, the membership chair, on the other hand, well, we've had a different one of those every year for the past 10 years. So looks like that chair will be vacant next year. So Hank, I'll be your president-elect. And thanks for letting me volunteer myself. I really appreciate you letting me do that.
Well, I didn't want you to have to find out like I did by reading the newsletter after I missed a meeting.
What about allowing the younger member to be president? I mean, there isn't an age requirement, right?
Well, it might be nice if that younger person was old enough to drink. But other than that, as long as you have a vocation and you're 18, you can be a member.
Come on, Hank, let's be real. The reason that a younger member hasn't been asked to be president is because that younger member might not know all of our traditions and might want to change things. And oh my goodness, that would not make our members happy now, would it?
Yeah, and it would probably actually help if we had some younger members. We don't exactly have a lot of those. No offense.
Well, sounds like we need to have another meeting. Stacy! Stacy, could you invite everybody at the club to come to a meeting for planning our future for next year? Sounds like we need to have some more input.
You guys had some great ideas today. Man, I wish I'd written them down.
Oh, don't worry about that. I've got it all right here. Never gonna be president now.
Never gonna be president now.
One less thing to worry about.
Welcome back, everybody. We're just really thrilled that you're here and watch the first video. Today, we've got the writers and the script writers and the producers and Mike and Ray here, and we thought we'd let them talk about the questions and go through what they were thinking when they wrote it and help us along through this path. So, Mike?
Yeah, you might be thinking, what were they thinking when they did this? And you might be okay in thinking that. So in your workbook, we've got some facilitation questions. And these questions are really for you to work on with your clubs, okay? And using the skit as an example, which is a safe thing to do, you might ask yourself, as in question one, what are some of the things that the Rotary Club of Good Intentions, that would be our fictional club, is not doing well? Your list, if your list matches ours, Ray, I think we had about 100 things just in that 10 minutes that they're not doing well and possibly not doing right. Isn't that right?
And Mike, I think that one of the things that's interesting is all the stories we used in this script were things that we'd actually seen in clubs. Mm-hmm. So it's not like we made up stories to do it. Now we changed the names and changed some of the other things to protect the innocent, but the basic concepts we actually have witnessed in clubs.
And sometimes they're actually actual situations and direct quotes, things that have actually happened to people. It's all there. So we're not making anything up. So if your club is, as in question two here, if some of these things could possibly be about your club, you might remind yourself that this is that you are not the Rotary Club of denial. You need to be you need to face those things, in my opinion. And I think that's what this is all about, is finding a safe way to face some of the things that may be preventing your club from getting to that next level, from being a vibrant club.
And I agree. I don't think that any club does all of these things wrong.
No.
But I think that every club does a couple of the things that is maybe holding them back.
Absolutely, I totally agree. And so, you know, as you'll notice from there, a lot of that first skit revolves around leadership. Okay, our leader, our fearless leader, Hank, comes busting in, and he's all full of vim and vinegar from Pets, and he thinks he's got it all solved. And yet he comes back to his club, and he faces quite a different situation, and he's forced to see the non-Kool-Aid-laced reality of his club versus the glory that Pets is. And so I could tell that Brent, as he was going through this, he was kind of going through a little bit of deja vu. just a little bit. So we're hoping that these questions that you will go over with your clubs will spark a good conversation, and it's a great starting point to figure out exactly where you are.
Mm-hmm. And I would encourage the board members that are on this webinar, be honest with your president and, you know, have these open discussions, because if you just gloss over it or think that it may not be important, it actually may be something that's actually holding your club back. So, you know, you're there fighting the battles, you're doing the stuff day to day. So be honest with your president, president-elects, and the other people in your clubs, and share your ideas and stuff like that. And I'm sure you can come up with good solutions.
For sure. Well said, right? And so this is a live streaming event. So we have our faithful companion, Beth, in the back room, who is monitoring the chat box and is there ready to relay your questions to us. So, Beth, do we have anything in the chat box at the moment? She said it's overwhelmed right now, and she's going to have to categorize each of your questions because there's so many of them. So we're going to get back to you on those. But it's good to see that so many people are engaged in this and really all about this live interaction and discussion. So one of the things you might be thinking about this first session is, well, gosh, why did Hank only talk to three people? You know, there's a lot more people in the club than that. And that'd be a very, very good observation, wouldn't you say so, Brent?
You know, I think that Hank was just doing what he thought he should be doing, was getting, you know, the few people that had to be, they're there. I mean, why would you go more than that? You really want to know what everybody thinks?
I don't think we do. But you know what? You're right. It could be overwhelming to face that many people. I mean, three was already enough. Hank was a little overwhelmed. He was a little man. And then when Stacy came in, oh my gosh, that set the whole thing off, didn't
right.
it?
Yes.
Absolutely. So,
well, and I also think that what he did was he tried to pick the ones that he thought were most important. One thing I think that Hank did well, though, is he actually talked to people together. You know, oftentimes a new president, because, you know, often our training in Rotary is just about one specific area, they just talk to the membership chair, and they just may talk to the marketing chair or the community service chair, but they don't bring them together so ideas can be discussed and that feeling of working together starts right away. So that's the thing I think Hank did well.
Yeah, he did. He knew that it was going to take a team. He knew he needed to have some key players, and he knew he was going to need some help. Right. I mean, the president can't do it all themselves. And if you leave it all to your president, that poor soul, I feel bad for them.
I think the other thing that he brought in, the leader team that he brought in, was actually fairly new members. That the first grouping was all pretty new members who saw it a little bit differently than sometimes the traditional would. And I think that gave him an advantage because they were honest enough to say, hey, this is really what's happening. Whereas sometimes if you've been in the club for 30 years, you're going, well, we did it that way and it's going to work and the club will still be here, so I'm not going to worry about it. Yeah. And I think that was really an advantage that Hank had.
Absolutely. I think Hank had a couple advantages there with that group. One, being able to tell his daughter just to show up there.
That's always an advantage.
Big advantage, knowing that you at least have one person show up because you probably drove them there. So. All right, great. So, we're taking cues from our stage manager. Could you tell? So subtle. But Hank did do that. But, you know, I think he also, he kind of fell back on his old ways. He also wanted everybody to see the positive. Right. He didn't want anybody to see the negative of what was going on. And he constantly pushed Stacy aside and said, look, I don't want anyone to know about this. It's all going to be good because we have to have momentum. We have to have positive momentum. Right. But sometimes that just continues the gloss over year after year after year, where, you know, underlying issues never get solved, never get looked at. And it can lead to deep resentment with some members. Don't you agree, Ray?
Yeah, I think that, you know, if you don't find out what those issues are, you know, we know we have a retention problem, that, you know, a lot of members, and especially new members, you know, they say most members leave in the first couple of years. If you stay in for 5 years, you're probably going to be, you know, buried as a Rotarian. But guess what? Why aren't we keeping those new members? And it's because we may not get that feedback from them to produce a club that they want to be part of.
Absolutely. And I think a big part of that first session was Alan.
Yeah.
You know, Alan was a character that was a character, but wasn't there.
Right.
And there, I think Alan represents a big part of this discussion in that, you know, were we missing out on things that when people left, did they leave because we just didn't listen to them?
Right. Yep.
You guys, we got a couple of questions.
Oh, excellent. Ben.
So in a large club, I do feel it's important to surround yourself with diverse opinions. But how do you get a well-rounded group without having all 100 members there? It can be a little overwhelming.
We feel that, sir. You're looking at me. So large. I came from a large club initially. I'm actually still in a semi-large club right now. But being part of one of the largest clubs in the district, yeah, it is challenging because you could have 100 opinions. But I will tell you this. You won't have 100 opinions because there is a group, and it's that old 80-20 rule. There's a group that's going to be very, very passionate about, you know, making the changes, moving the club in a certain direction, and when it's about getting them to work together and listen to each other to get to the right place while not overlooking maybe some other people. And I think if you give everybody the opportunity to be heard, I think that's the key first step.
Right.
Open it up and say, I don't care if there are 20, 40, 60, or all 100 of you here. I want to hear it all. We're going to be here. We're going to make sure that everybody gets heard. Would you not agree, Ray?
I agree. And being from a larger club also, I think one of the things you have to look at is sometimes you have to go out and talk to those people, especially the ones that are not getting involved, because you may not be satisfying what they their perception of what the club should have been. So sometimes you'll have to reach out to them and talk with them because, again, if they're on that edge of losing them, they probably have some opinions why they're not getting what they want out of the club.
Well, and that's where leadership comes in. I mean, if everybody has these one-on-one conversations with other club members where they feel safe to be able to air their grievances or opinions about things. And it's your, I guess, responsibility to then carry that forward so that they can be heard, or get them and encourage them to say, hey, you know, come to this, be part of the group. It's safe. And making a safe place, I think, is extraordinarily important in that. Yeah. Beth, do we have any more questions over there?
Yes. Can club members go anywhere else for help or get examples of success?
So, rather than examples of non-success like this one, I think we have a lot of great clubs that have some success. Would you not agree, Ray?
Yes. And one of the things that we'll be talking about at the end of this webinar today, we'll have a survey. It's a one-question survey, so easy enough to pick out. But it'll have all kinds of different areas that you want to help on. So what we're going to ask you to do is fill out that survey, pick as many of those items you want. If you have other ideas, pick that out, and we will try to put together those training programs to help you and your club be successful. But we need to know what you feel is important, and that's why we're going to do that after the session's over. I also will give you a little hint. I think that some of the answers will come up throughout the rest of the video.
We got 5 more sessions to go. And as your district membership chair and your district governor and your immediate past district governor, I mean, we have, by doing this, we are here for you. So if you have us, we would absolutely love to come out and speak with you or speak with you over Zoom and help you work through your problems. All you need to do is reach out. Beth, do we have any more questions there?
No, but Russell says need someone to slap my for calling it a semi-large club. They're still a large club.
Thanks, Russell. I'll mind my P's and Q's. Yes, an extra large club. That's how we just call them, extra large.
Some people.
I'm going to treat that with respect because I understand. Pride in your club is awesome. So that was it. Okay. Awesome. So I think we're ready to move on to our next session. So with that, our next session kind of continues the saga of Hank.
Yes.
And his club. And I think what we've just discussed is going to dovetail nicely in that.
Yep.
I'd like to thank you all for being here. I was hoping that more of our club would attend, but you are the 20% that get things done in this club. I'd like to ask the three of you who are new to let us know why you decided to come to this meeting.
Well, I have 55 years of perfect attendance. And I'm here because I want to make sure that our Bacchus for Adolescence Project is here. It's a program I started way, way back when I was president. Now, we stopped giving away the green badges with each advocate, but I'd be damned if I'm going to let you guys stop this program while I'm still alive.
Okay, John. Thanks for being here. We definitely want to make sure that all voices in the club are heard. How about you, Jimmy?
Well, you know, I've been the head chef for the Crafty for the past few years, and you know, I think it's time we innovate with shrimp. I think it'll make a really big difference.
Okay, Jimmy. We're all about new ideas here for sure. How about you, Christina?
Well, I've been really thinking about how we can put this club on the map. What do you think about a 3-day hip-hop music concert? We can rent out the university stadium, 30,000 people a day. My son, he's got people who are up-and-comers as far as performers. They'd be willing to do it for free. And I am sure that we can reach out to talent who, once they find out the money is going to charity, they'll give us a special rate. I mean, what do you guys think?
That would take all clubs in our district to pull off.
But we could keep all the profits, right?
Hold on, guys. We aren't there yet. I don't think we could staff a lemonade stand right now, let alone a music festival.
We didn't make you president so you can tell us what to do. You know, why does every president that comes in either want to do everything new this year, their way, or do the same thing over and over again?
Hey, guys, I don't think this is what Hank brought us all together here. I think what he really wants to find out is, you know, what our community needs, what we all want to do, and then what we can do well.
Yeah, exactly. Thanks, Bill. I really couldn't have said that better myself. We had a meeting recently where it became pretty clear, pretty fast, that we needed to change what we're doing if we want to grow as a club. This is what we were going to talk about today. I thought it would be a good idea to ask everybody who wanted to help rather than just telling people they had to show up.
Well, I like that. Because if you just asked me just to show up as you were, I probably wouldn't. Besides, we all know that our schools need the advocates for each student each and every year.
Well, you know, I've talked with my kids' teachers, and they say they're not using them. And in fact, the kids either take them home or set them on fire.
Well, instead of wooden ones, we can give metal ones.
Uncle John, I don't think that's the point. I think we should be asking the schools what they need, not giving them what we think they need.
You know, I could ask the school superintendent what the needs are of the district. I'm on the PTA board, and so I see her really often and see what she has to say.
You know, could you introduce me to her at some point? You know, I've heard a lot about her, and I think she might make a really good member of our club.
Yeah, sure.
Do you think maybe there are other people in your PTA that might be interested? Maybe we could crash one of their meetings, and we could find out from them, like, what are the needs of our community? There's lots of people in PTA that are involved in stuff.
And then they might think about joining our club.
Whoa, Tiger. Let's ease into this. So, Jeff, yes, you make a great point. There are quite a few people on my PTA board that are involved with other nonprofits.
Like what?
Well, like you might expect, kids stuff. So the sports, the arts, nonprofits that have to do with helping kids with special needs.
Well, why aren't we partnering with some of those nonprofits to get some of our community service done?
It's not just community service. If we partner with them for our crab feed, for our fundraisers, and make them a major beneficiary, then maybe we'll get more attendance and volunteers. And of course, we can shrink too.
We tried getting the groups involved about 20 years ago. It just doesn't work. We all know what we want. We know what's best for our club.
John, things have changed drastically around here over the last 20 years, not to mention 2020 alone. I mean, this year, my goodness. I bet you didn't know that in our metro area alone, over 400 new nonprofit organizations have formed just to serve the needs of our community.
Is that true?
Why didn't they just join us and together we could have addressed those needs?
But hey, let's face it, we're the best kept secret in our community. I mean, these people don't even know we exist. We don't even register a meaningful percentage of our community's population, let alone represent it in any meaningful way with respect to diversity.
That's why we're all here. How can we change that? How can we get visibility?
What about like the city council or the chamber of commerce?
What about the community outreach of our first responders?
How about businesses we all do business with?
You know, the police chief used to be a member of our club, and I play poker with him every single week. I think I can get back to the club. He's the past has been a great resource and a supporter of our club.
Now, this is what I'm talking about. These are great ideas that we really do need to commit to following up on. But Bill, something you said really concerns me.
What's that?
The fact that we represent an insignificant percent of our population, and more significantly, the fact that we don't look like our community as a whole.
Actually, while we've been talking, I did some research on my iPad, and here are some really interesting facts for you. So our metro area has grown 18% in the last decade. Our club has decreased in membership 30% over the same period. And don't get me started about the demographics of our community. We look nothing like it. You're absolutely right about that.
You know, I got some great brains in this club, but, you know, we could use a little bit more color.
I know we've said in the past that all we need to do is get one and they'll bring their friends and our problems will be solved. But that's like checking a box. I mean, it's not like we even care about who we're bringing in. I mean, not only is that wrong, it's just not going to work.
How do we fix that?
I'll tell you how we fix that. You know, it's no different than how we were all asked to join this club, right? We were told that there were a bunch of like-minded individuals who wanted to take action in their communities to make their communities better and change the world. But when I first came to this club and came to my first meeting, that's not what I experienced. This club did not embrace me. In fact, I couldn't even find a chair to sit in. Now, you asked me how to fix it. I'll tell you how to fix it. We got to start living what we stand for. We have to reach out to people in our community and find out what service they want done. We have to first get to know them as people before asking them to join our club. If you treat people like I was treated and try to attract people that way, you're not going to get the result you want. In fact, it's going to be quite the opposite. And in these specific groups, if you treat them that way, you might have some very unintended consequences. And then we're going to have no chance to make a difference.
But we are friendly, right?
I think that needs to be a program at our next meeting. And we need everyone on board with what you're talking about. Stacy, can you set another meeting in 2 weeks? Meanwhile, can everyone who mentioned doing outreach to various aspects of our community please do so over the next 2 weeks? Let's gain some knowledge about where we live before we draw any more conclusions. I know this was difficult, but I want to thank you for all being honest and working to make our situation better.
Brent, before we get started, we have a question. Are the men allowed to wear Birkenstocks to their board meetings?
Absolutely. One of the most comfortable shoes I've ever had.
Obviously, as you can see, the actor who played Hank in our little video here was very comfortable doing the shooting, and he was one of the most relaxed of us all. It truly showed.
Yes, absolutely. Piece of cake. Well, it was so well scripted, it was piece of cake. Hey, Ray, so in some of the discussions on this one, you know, it's about knowing your community. I mean, we're Rotary clubs. We clearly have been around a while.
we are the community, right?
Well, yes, we are, but
of course we are.
I think that that's something we forget to do. You know, so often we talk about the club survey,
right.
And it's like we got to survey our members. We got to do this. As you can see in the video here, out of this club of 50, we only had about 20% of them show up for this. And you don't really know how much your members actually really know what's going on in the community. Mm-hmm. I mean, not that we don't know the basic stuff, but you know, we don't know it like the fire chief or the police chief or the principal of the school knows it. And if we don't start by asking them what are the issues in the community, how are we going to try to decide and give options to our members that don't know that, what they should be doing? So I always think that the first thing you need to do is that community assessment. And then once we get that and get the leaders of the community to tell us what the needs are, we can fine tune those and find the ones that we think we can actually accomplish and then give our members options, realistic options of what they might want to do.
Yeah, and you know, that's a great point about getting that survey. It's not one person in the club going out and getting that survey. As you saw in the video, that we had several members that had different ins with the community, right? That, you know, John had the in with the police chief, and Christina had the in with the PTA, and so you had different people, and I'm sure that Dee Dee had lots of different connections because she's in media and marketing. So I think that you have a great resource in your club members because not everybody is necessarily seeing the same thing. Mm-hmm. And so to have a committee go out and do that and have different people, just like Hank did, which is right. Another great thing that Hank is starting to do some very good things in this. he was actually telling people, hey, let's get out there and let's find out really what's going on and what's needed.
Yeah. I also think that that's a good time to also reevaluate what you've done in the past.
Right.
You know, we joked and, you know, we're giving out advocacies.
Advocacies for adolescents.
But you know, even myself, I mean, I saw my mom use one, but I've never actually used one in my life.
I'm an accountant, Ray. I've never used one.
But just think if you had a project like that that you thought was really important, you had members that were passionate about, you know, how are you going to let them down and know that we need move to a new direction,
right?
And find something to replace that because it's past its time. And I think that's what you can do when you go out to the community and talk to them is say, what do you think? And, you know, as
and Christine, bring an abacus with you.
And what Christine says is, you know, she was getting feedback from the school.
Right.
And that was a needed thing to make decisions for future projects.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. And also, you kind of saw there, Bill chimed in kind of cheekily. Hey, maybe I can use this as a way to get some new members for the club.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's true. He was being a little cheeky. And Christina told him to, you know, whoa there, Tiger, right? He told him to slow down because I think Christina also gets it. She has this group that she's kind of protective of. You know, she's part of the PTA now, and she doesn't want, you know, Rhoda to bust in there. Like, come on, we need all you people here in the PTA to join us. You know, it doesn't really work like that. And we're going to explore that a little bit more as we go. And I think Bill kind of said that at the end of the session was, you know, there's a way to do things. And the way we all got in to Rotary is through friends and through this sort of, you know, like-minded way of thinking,
right.
You know, and relationships and Lord knows getting together with people, which we're, you know, we're all looking forward to getting back into doing here, hopefully within the next 12 months. But I think that's another key part about it is relationships and then getting to know people. I mean, Ray, I mean, obviously you can speak to that better than I can.
Yeah. Well, I think that, I mean, Christina did a great job when she said, you know, stop. We just don't want to barge in there and try to pass out proposal forms to people in a room that may not know us. We need to get to know them first. They need to know us, and they need to see where there's that common synergy before we even ask them to join us for something like that. Once we do that, then we can actually go out and start inviting to them events and letting them get to know us. Absolutely. But let's have those relationships first so we don't harass them and make them feel like we're pressuring them.
Right. And you talk about those relationships and that kind of leads me into the discussion that we wanted to make sure we put into this section was that section, you know, the conversation about diversity and the conversation of how you bring diversity in your club and bringing diversity and you bring in diversity just for diversity's sake. What if that doesn't look like community? We focused on looking like your community. And in most communities here, especially District 51A, there is diversity.
Yeah.
So it's just about, okay, now how do you approach that if your club doesn't look like that, right?
Yeah. It's been interesting because some of you out there might have listened to my talk on diversity recently, and I've had that particular question come up. You know, how do we do that? Well, again, it's building that relationship. You know, if you don't aren't working or doing the things that those communities feel are important to you, why would they come to us? So we've had to find out what's important to them, find out who they are and stuff like that, and see if there's a synergy. If so, then they're more apt to want to be part of what we're doing. And you'll see that through the video series. I think we do a pretty good job of showing how we kind of build on that and go out and talk to those communities in a way that we're not trying to ask them to join Rotary. We're trying to find out what's important to them.
Yeah. And how can we help and how can we get together and help?
Yeah.
Brett, you have something on?
Well, I was going to say, I think the surprising thing is so often we're in Rotary and we're not seeing other nonprofits that have been formed. And yet they're working within our community and we don't know about them. And so how do we find out? And they're growing. And so how do we connect with them and maybe help them do their projects and help us do our projects? And I think there's a real challenge there. But when we started this, you know, there are over 400 nonprofits formed in a pretty short time when you look at our district. And we just kind of have to figure out how to keep up with them. And that takes being out in the community and talking to our members who might well be members of them.
Absolutely. And that 400 number is a real number. And that actually happened. When we first launched Rotary Reboot a year ago at the 3-in-1 seminar, which became Rotary Reboot, that came up. One of our presidents from one of our clubs mentioned that, hey, it's so hard to get new members because we've had so many new nonprofits show up and everybody's going to join them and do things with those nonprofits. Well, why are they doing that when we do that?
Yeah.
Wait a second. So obviously we're not getting our message out here. So again, that kind of prompted this whole, you know, again, get out in the community, find out what's going on, because otherwise you're going to wake up one day and find out that everybody else is doing all the service because you didn't get out there to figure out what needed to get done.
Right. And I think that if you look, you don't have to necessarily replace them. You can partner with them.
Absolutely.
You know, my club, the Fair Oaks Club, has done a great job in the last year or so working with the food bank. And the director is now a member of our club. We're doing a lot of work out there. It's giving us an opportunity, especially in these times, to have a safe project that we can work on. So we're not just giving them money. We're out there doing it. They have actually what was kind of deemed Rotary days where you could come and get food from them because their demands really gone up and they needed that additional help.
And now Rotary days are every day, right, Brad?
Yeah.
Not that much. We don't have that much people working out there. But I think you kind of get the idea is here's a great partnership. It's good for them. It's good for us. It gives us the exposure. It gives us something to market that says that this is some of the good stuff we do in the community. And they get the benefit from it, too. So it's a win-win for both nonprofits.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Beth, do we have anything coming through on the chat line? Oh, get once again overwhelmed. And okay, we... Yes.
And says the food bank is a great idea these days. Our club has been volunteering and donating money to the Yolo County Food Bank.
That's excellent.
Yeah.
That helps us find out. We've also been doing things with Rise Against Hunger.
Mm-hmm.
That's another nonprofit that a member of our Rotary Passport Club, Rotary Passport One, is heavily engaged with, and he's gotten our club to do quite a few events out there, and I think other clubs have done them as well. Great way to focus on that as an effort. Mm-hmm. Totally. So that was good. I see Beth's a little overwhelmed at the switchboard. Just to kind of give her a chance to catch her breath there. You know, these questions that we asked you to talk about here in the facilitated discussion, the workbook, do center around community. All right. The first two are very heavily involved in the community. But I think that the one thing that we want you to take away from this is the fact that, you know, really be open to what you see. Try not to filter anything. I mean, you may not end up doing anything about it, but at least hear it out. At least try to take it in. Try to bring it in. And again, you're going to see here in session three that it could have some very, very positive results. And again, everything that you're watching in these videos are comments that Rotarians have made in this district and things that have happened. So you will see this coming up in session three. Beth, you have a question?
Yeah, someone asks, how can clubs share connections? So many folks work and live in one place, but are part of clubs in another geographic area and may not be fully invested in their club's area.
Ooh. Well,
wow.
You know, I think that there's lots of ways you can do that. And just because you're a member of a particular club, does that mean that you or your club can't partner with somebody else?
Or get a treasure from another club.
Yes. You know, if you look this year at the Folsom clubs, not only have they kind of been separate and worked on different projects year after year, so they've never really come together. This year, the three presidents of PETS actually came together and says, you know what? We're going to work together. So they put out a hashtag that's the Folsom Rotary Clubs. Every time any one of the clubs has a project, they discuss it with the other one, say, hey, do you want to participate too? And it allows them to work together. But you can do that alongside any club. I remember, you know, since I got a good friend that's up in Auburn, I've actually done service projects with Auburn clubs in the past. I've gone to fundraisers up there because I know the people up there, I like them, and I want to help out. So I don't have to just do it in my own club. I can be a Rotarian and be a Rotarian in other parts of our community.
Because you are a Rotarian.
Yes.
Beth, did you have a question there?
Yeah, someone asks, how can we get connected with Jim for packing events?
Ooh, you can reach out to Jim. Actually, email me, michaelrenero@yahoo.com. I'll put you in touch with Jim because he's a member of the Rotary Passport One Club with me. So I'll make sure we get that information right out to you. He's a great guy to work with. It's a lot of fun working out there doing the packing. And it's 4 hours that'll fly by like that, and you'll never know that you were there and you just fed
Yeah,
1,800 people. It's amazing what you're able to do.
Yeah, and it really works well in our area. And Yuba Sutter area, our three clubs are doing a Rise Against Hunger next month. It's really easy to get together with other clubs and do that together.
And safely.
And so it's just a terrific. And Jim is just fantastic to work with. And if you can't get a hold of Mike, get a hold of me, and I'll make sure that Jim gets a hold of you. But it's a fantastic organization to work with, and really proud to be working with them.
Perfect.
Excellent. And they are a Rotary partner now.
Right.
Excellent. That's great. Good to know. Beth?
Yeah. Can larger clubs in the area advertise their service projects so the small clubs can join in?
I've always been a big promoter of that, as you all know. I would say the answer is yes. But I'm going to have to throw it to you, Brent, because that sounds like me something that the district needs to kind of find a way to provide a bulletin board so that that communication can happen. What do you think?
I think that's a great idea, and I think we'll work on that. I think that the smaller clubs have a harder time, especially during this time, finding those projects that they're able to do. And so we're working together in our smaller clubs. A lot of them are doing food bank work and the Rise Against Hunger. But I think if there are projects that the bigger clubs have the ability to put together, it would be fantastic to let the other clubs help them. And I think it would be good for everybody.
Yeah.
Let me jump into there. It's just not other Rotarians. I think that if you're doing service projects or you have any type of event, you should be out there marketing that. So whether it's on Facebook or on your website or any other way, you should be reached out to the whole community, because there's a lot of other people that are looking for things to do, and that's how people get the Rotary experience and really find out. So if you're just trying to talk to other Rotarians, that's great, but why not talk to the whole community and see who else might want to join in?
Yeah, and a perfect example of that, just this week in our area, one of our club members is the head of the Yuba Sutter Arts, and they're doing a Japanese Memorial prison camp site, and they needed cleanup. And they were inviting everybody in the community to come. So Rotarians showed up to help clean up along with many of the artists in our community and interact clubs. And I think we need to also follow up when other people need help, so that when we need help, they want to show up and help us.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So Beth, how are we doing there? Excellent. Okay. I think that we are going to move right on into the next session. I think we've done a pretty good conversation here. So
don't hurt yourself patting yourself on the back. Well,
So here's session three. I'm going to put out a little viewer advisory. There is a scene in the next video that has a very animated and upset older member that is upset that he is losing something and his club is slipping away from him. And he uses some language. It is bleeped out, but I just want to warn everybody that it is there.
So that if you don't want to watch that, then please just turn off your computer.
Just turn off the audio for
us. Just turn off the audio.
Yeah.
When you see Jimmy, played by Ray, sitting with Dee Dee, played. Oh, excuse me.
That's what I was going to say. I did that last time,
Jeff,
too.
Played by Dee Dee. You can turn down your volume if you don't want to listen to that portion of the video. But otherwise, again, it's all real. So please enjoy.
So, Hank, why so tense?
I'm not tense, I'm just thinking.
I take it that's something you don't do very often?
No, I mean, yes. I mean, why are we having this conversation? I need your help.
So is that so hard to say?
We are friends, right? I'm worried when everybody comes back, we may find out that we're irrelevant, that we could cease to exist tomorrow and no one would even care, that no one in our club actually cares enough to commit to making things better.
I care, Hank, and I know you do too. I know this club means what this club means to you and your family. We're going to make this work. We just need to get everyone together.
We need to have a club assembly, and not one of those club assemblies where we're just checking off a box for the district governor or, you know, trying to get an award at Rotary International, but a real assembly with real people. People like you and me, and who care and are committed to making this club all it can be.
Okay, Hank, going over the top there. How about just getting the club together to be open and honest?
I think that'll work too. We already have a bunch of information gathered by our team over the past 2 weeks about our community needs and makeup. We need to learn more about where we stand as a club and our club members.
Hank, I think it's more than that. Yes, I think we need to know how each member feels about things we do as a club, but we also need to know a couple more things. Mm-hmm. Look at my list here. One, what are our club members interested individually in doing? Mm-hmm. And two, what are the skills and talents of our members that can help us achieve our goals?
Wow, that really could help us keep our members happy and also keep them engaged and motivated. First thing I want to do is, why are only 40% of our membership even coming to our meetings?
Mm, sounds like we too. Great way to start this survey.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. What I got here is question one, why don't you show up? Question two, what would make you show up? Question three, would a free Uber or Lyft help you show up?
I think now you're just stepping way over the top there, Stacy. We need one that actually will answer.
Okay, Hank, here is the final.
Fantastic.
Ready? Question one, why do you continue to pay your dues each year? Question two, if you show up to our meetings, why? If not, why not? Question three, did you attend the service project last year? If so, why? If not, why? Question four, other than buying a ticket, did you help out of a fundraiser last year? If not, why not?
Okay.
During the past, or question five, sorry. Mm-hmm. During the past 12 months, did you talk about Rotary to somebody who is not a Rotarian? If yes, did you invite them to visit a club event? If no, why not?
Okay.
Question six, are you a member of any other local nonprofit organization? If yes, could we partner with this organization for service and how? Question 7, we've identified the needs within our local school district. Would you be excited about participating in one of the following projects that directly benefits our kids and schools? Mentoring at an after-school, an at-risk athletic program, improving the elementary school computer lab, reading assistance in an elementary school reading room like Dr. Seuss. Right. Question 8, the Hispanic Chamber wants to partner with us as a business leadership program. Would you be interested in volunteering your time and expertise? And question 9, would you be in favor of which of the following? Continuing with our existing fundraiser as is, continuing with our existing fundraisers with changes like shrimp, continuing with our existing fundraiser and adding an additional fundraiser, or ceasing our existing fundraiser and adding a new one in place of it?
Question 10.
We have identified 3 potential new fundraising events. Which of these would you be in favor of exploring? A chili cook-off engaging local businesses and nonprofits, a music festival featuring local bands, food, and beverages, or a virtual auction where we promote stuff for sale.
Wow, Stacy, those are great. We're going to get fantastic information out of that. Get that thing emailed out right away. Thanks, everyone, and make sure you really don't hold back on that survey. You should also have a copy in your email. Encourage members who weren't here to fill theirs out and send it in to Stacy. This meeting is adjourned.
You know, Hank really didn't promote my ideas in the survey. I know shrimp is what we need to take it to take the crappie to the next level.
I'll be honest with you, Jimmy. I'm worried that the club doesn't really have what it takes to make the changes that we need to make to get to that next level.
Yeah, we're going to lose some people.
You know, we both know that we really need to do more to raise some money. And the only way that's going to happen is if we get more people involved. And right now, we have, what, 50 people in the club. Maybe 10 people show up for these things. I don't think we can do it that way. We're going to have to think out of the box, maybe partner with some other clubs. I know the Breakfast Club is having the same problem we are.
Yeah, I think every club is having the same problems we are having. But we need the money for our foundation to do what we always do.
Jimmy, can I call you Jimmy?
You can call me Bubba.
I'm telling you, Jimmy, work with me on this, and I will promote this event so hard the whole community is going to know about it. It is going to be a huge hit. What do you say, Bubba?
Jimmy, have you seen this? Where's my abacus for adolescents program?
You mean abacus for adolescents, right?
Whatever. I knew this was going to well happen. Then I'm going to show Hank. I'm not going to fail on this circuit. He can go himself.
John?
Jess, I'm so sorry. I really shouldn't have said that. I'm really sorry.
I get it, John. I get it. It's, yeah, I mean, I understand where you're coming from, and I can feel your frustration, but the club really does need to change and evolve with the times. I mean, just like it did when your project was relevant, when you pushed for your project to become our thing, right? Times are changing fast, and we have got to change with them. The point here is we need to do projects, both fundraisers and our service projects in the community that both our club members and the community actually care about.
Okay, Jess, I get it. I really get it. I'm just passionate about our club. I really want us to survive. And you know, if I had a choice between my project and the club, it's gonna be the club every time.
I'm glad to hear you say that, John. You know, I might lose my shrimp.
What?
Oh, I'll tell you later.
Hey, Bill, wait up. Listen, this whole survey business has me really nervous. I wanted a new project, not several new projects. I'm not sure I'm going to have the time to do all of this.
Wait, who said anything about you having to do this all by yourself?
Well, I'm the community service chair. Who else is going to do it?
Your committee?
What is this committee of which you speak, and where can I find them?
Now, what you do is you promote your project within the club. Talk about it, get people interested. And as you see those people getting interested, you kind of approach them and say, hey, why don't you become involved and get them, see if they might be maybe inclined to lead that project and help you.
Sounds so easy the way you just said it, but what if that doesn't happen?
It'll happen. With your enthusiasm and your excitement, I absolutely believe that you're going to be able to find a great committee. I'll tell you what, as I'm finding prospective members and looking to bring them into the club, I'll hit them up as well. See if they for your project as well. And at the end of the day, I'm always here to support you.
Thanks, Phil. I feel better now.
You're going to make a great president someday. Probably better than your dad. Just don't tell him I said so.
Got it.
Taking surveys. We all really want to know what our club thinks of us.
You know what? That's a comment I made to start this whole off. Do we really want to know? And I think the answer is yes, but the problem has always been gathering the data. Right. And a lot of times I think people, you know, survey and they, do I have to actually write something? Can I just check a box? And a lot of that I think is, you know, we really haven't focused on the why. You know, why are we doing this? And again, that's kind of why this all showed up in session three, is because there's things that have to happen before that.
Right.
So you can make the survey more meaningful and make it a little more like voting, right? And if you'll notice the survey that is actually part of your workbook, you'll see a lot of things here that were discussed in the previous sessions when we did the community survey and whatnot.
Right.
We use those for the member survey. So we give them a little bit of direction so they didn't have to think of it all on their own. Would you agree, right?
Yeah, I think that a key portion of it is doing that community assessment first, is that, you know, as the chairs of the different committees, you can find out, you know, these are a bunch of needs, and you can maybe toss some of them out. You know, we'd love to do that, but, you know, it'd take a club two times our size and you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars to do, so you don't have to put that in a survey. But if you just ask a member what should they do, they may not know.
Right.
So if you give them options, they can say, oh, this sounds good or this sounds better. And you've already kind of pre-looked at it and know that it's something that the club can accomplish.
Right. And sometimes even do something you really want, you have to face that possible rejection, like Jimmy and shrimp. Jimmy really wanted the shrimp, but his shrimp was in the survey. And that was his big fear at the end of that middle part of the session. That could go away. He may lose it, but he realized that could possibly happen. That has to be out there in the open. Mm-hmm. It really does.
And I think that that's really good, because now people are invested in it. You know that if they say, this is the project really we want, you've got a group of people that are now wanting to do it and are committed to doing it, and you're going to get that participation that sometimes that at like the end when Beth and Mike are talking.
Bill.
And Sarah. Whatever their stage names were. When they were talking, you know, you could see that if you know from the survey that you have those people, now you can start building those committees. You can start building the people that are going to work those projects. And it's so much easier because they've already answered it and told you they want to do it.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's what made it so easy for Hank and Stacy to put together the survey. And time lapse did help.
Yeah.
These surveys take a little while to put together. But I think once they had all the information, it flowed fairly easily and they kept each other grounded. So and the president was involved. And I think that you have to be both, because you still know everything, right, as the president.
Everything. Everything.
And they did it without drinking. You know, they turned down beer.
One of us did.
So, Brent, you went through that. What did you think about that?
I thought it was really good, but it was so important to have the information first from the community before we start doing the survey. I think the other thing that it allows with the community input and then doing the survey is the club believes you'll use the survey. So how often have we done a survey and then, well, I don't like that idea as president. I don't like that. So we're doing it the president's way.
I don't like the results of this one. The survey is going to go.
We must have asked the wrong questions.
Because otherwise I would have heard what I wanted to hear.
That's right.
So true. It's absolutely true. I think another thing too, this survey, you know, it is 10 questions. That can seem a little daunting, but if you look at the questions, they really cover the gambit,
yeah.
Right? They're covering what we do in service. How do you feel about the fundraising projects? You know, how do you feel about membership? What do you feel personally about your dues and what value you're getting out? So it really does cover the gambit. And I think if that's explained when you're going and presenting the survey, I think that really makes a difference about people wanting to put a little effort into it.
Right.
Would you not agree?
Yeah, I really do. And again, it's all about engagement, because if we forget about that, again, you can bring in 100 new members, but if you're losing 110 at the end of the year, you've gone backwards.
Exactly.
And this is a great way of doing it. And I would also suggest that you kind of look at pieces of the survey as questions when you're inviting someone to participate in your Rotary Club. Because if you know that they have the same goals and the same things, they want to do the same things that your club's doing, then they're going to come in and be an engaged member right away.
Agreed, Ray. Agreed. Hey, Beth, I think you have a question over there.
Yeah, we got one from a president.
Ooh.
Any tips for getting members to fill out surveys? I started one and got 4 responses back.
Well, at a club of 5, I would say that was a great, great. If your club has 100, like the extra large club we heard from earlier, that's probably pretty poor. But also not completely out of the realm of possibility. Again, I think it, from my perspective, and I'll get your comments on this gentleman, from my perspective, I think you have to answer the why first. I think you have to say, look, this is extraordinarily important, and this is why. But what do you think, Brent?
Yeah, I think that the leadership, you know, so you've got your chairs, and they're saying, we need this survey. We need to know what you guys think, because we're trying to help our community, and if we don't have your input and your buy-in, you know, for this year, we're going to have a harder time meeting the needs of our community.
Well, so, people helping.
Yeah, we'll have 5 people helping out of our, you know, 150 members. And so I think it's really important. And again, it comes back to, they need to know that if they take the survey, that, you know, it's not, they're not complaining. We're wanting to know what they need, and so that we can make changes within the club. That's hard to do, but you've got to start making changes so the members believe that their survey counts.
Agreed. Ray, what do you think?
A couple of things. One is I do think it has to be sold. And that was one of the questions that came back. Did Hank really sell it at the club, how important it is, and some of the things that were important to the club members? But I think the other thing is, if people don't fill it out, you need to find out why on that too, which means that you, especially if you're a bigger club, this becomes more difficult,
right?
Is you need to reach out to some of these people, especially those unofficial leaders in your club. So ones that maybe don't have a leadership position that people look to as the leader of the club, and say, you know, why aren't people filling it out? Can we talk to some people? Can we get some of these unofficial leaders, as well as the board members, really enthusiastic about them, and have they pushed the survey and let them give the reasons why it's important for the club and the strength and longevity of the club?
You know, one of the things, Ray, I just thought of, that, you know, we've always tried to make sure that these surveys have been highly confidential, right? Mm-hmm. So we get honesty out of members so that we'll actually truly, you know, understand what they think. We don't want them to be pressured by the group or pressured into not saying something. But that said, you know, I think that, you know, I think you can still have that privacy in filling out a survey at possibly a club meeting. Mm-hmm. You could make that the program. We've got a survey, and we'd like to hear questions from you as you. So there's an interaction there as they're filling out the survey to go through it. And so once everybody's done, you collect all the surveys from everybody's at the meeting, and away you go. Now, obviously, that assumes that you can get everybody at a meeting.
Right.
But what it does too is it kind of is an extension of that session too, where, right, Hank got, you know, asked the club members to come together to have an open discussion, and he got 8, right? This sort of kind of forces the issue of saying, look, I really am serious about this, and I want to listen to you, and I really want us to work together. And I think the clubs that do that and are the most vocal and open about what they want tend to come closer, mm-hmm, and they tend to have greater participation and greater attendance, right? So, Beth's got a question.
Yeah, someone asks, in the greater SAC area, most media outlets cover the whole area. Couldn't 5180 clubs assemble a 5180 media contact guide consisting of existing media relationships that all clubs could use to publicize events, projects, etc.?
right?
I think it's a great idea. You know, we've tried that in the past, and unlike John, I'm not saying that that's why we haven't done it, but we had some issues on that. What I think we can really do is if anybody out there has those connections and can help us, we would love to do that. But, you know, we had some people that have tried to form those type of things, and they really didn't have the contact, so it really didn't go anywhere. So we need some help on that. And I'm sure that Brent and Dee Dee would be happy to have them join those teams and put together a committee to do that. We just need, you know, we really need your help.
We need your help. So, Beth, another question.
Yeah, someone says, I'm running into people saying, it's a great idea, but it's going to take till at least next year to try to get it to fly. It's too late in my year to make changes, and we don't have enough money to do it right now.
So that's a great statement. I think I know where this person is going with this question, is that they would really like to do something now, but because of certain restrictions and whatnot, that might not be possible. People might not be motivated to doing something now versus later. This is a challenge, and we've talked about this even off camera here, where I've said, look, we are a in-person club. I like being here with Brent. I like being here with Ray and my buddies, David Dean and Steve Lemon and Beth here, who are helping us out, crew this thing, which we are very, very grateful and thankful for them. But without this, it takes a big part of Rotary away. Mm-hmm. It really does. And I think that, you know, from my perspective, I'm going to throw this to you, Ray. From my perspective, you've got to appeal to them saying, look, we got to do something, and I would really like some help because we need to bridge. What do you think?
Well, I think the downside of the question or comment that I heard was it had to be done in a Rotary year. Why does it have to be done in a Rotary year? You know, if it's a great project and the club's behind it, who cares when it starts? It may take 6 months to plan something and put it in place. And I would suggest, you know, this is a great time to start making those plans, you know, getting the people involved. The comment was made, they didn't have the money. That means you need to have a fundraiser. So maybe you don't do the project until you get the funds to do it. But I looked at this as a very positive thing. You got a great idea here. Let's get the club to rally around the idea and put it in place whenever it can happen.
Well, let me throw something else at you. Succession.
Yep.
We've talked a lot about, you know, it's not just 1 year. The best clubs have this succession going on where the years blend together and the leadership for multiple years to come work together to say, look, we may have this overarching project and things that are sustained. And we're going to see a little bit about that in the next session, talked about sustainability. But that, I think, is another thing that makes clubs vibrant and strong is when they work through multiple years with a group of leaders. Brent, don't you agree?
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And as somebody who's been a president twice, everything happened really good after I was not president.
Well, you know, guys, I think that this whole session we're doing right now, or this whole webinar we're doing, is a perfect example of what you're just talking about. You know, last year we did our first Rotary reboot where we said, hey, we want to get different chairs in a club to work together and think of things together. And this, we've taken it to another level. And that's because, you know, when Brent and I talked about it, we talked about what the idea was Rotary reboot the first time. He says, yeah, it sounds great. And if it works, you know, we're going to do it, you know, we're going to take it to the next level next year. And that's what we did. And I think that's the way clubs should look at things too, is, you know, build off of stuff, you know, and sometimes you're going to take a risk and maybe it won't work, but if it does work, just build on it.
Build on, right? Exactly. Yeah. Iterate and keep moving. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So no, that's great. Beth, phone lines overloaded again, huh? Okay. Well, we'll let you do your little tasks there and handle that heavy traffic and call volume. One of the things that did come up, you know, we're having this discussion and we wanted to have an open discussion to kind of facilitate the discussion that we hope that you have.
Okay, so we're looking at you to get together with your clubs once this is concluded, sort of like the way we did the assembly. Oh my gosh, it seems like so long ago, right? Where we had these presenters and we offered some food for thought to you and then said, hey, now over lunch, get together with your clubs and now discuss. Mm-hmm. Look, take what you saw, take what you heard, and then apply it to your club, ask the questions, and get the feedback. And I think that's what we're really hoping for here, is to give you this. Give you the chance to ask questions, to get things clarified, hear a little bit about why we did these things and what went into the script, and then get together with your club once this is done, once you've taken it all in, and then figure out your strategy from there. Don't you agree, Ray?
Yeah, because this could be the basis for your plan. And again, you know, we're not doing it at the start of a Rotary year, but it doesn't really matter. It's a long-term plan to make your club stronger. It's all we're thinking about, and that's why we're doing it now, is let's get it together. It's not necessarily have to run with a Rotary year. It's just about getting everybody to start working together and, you know, finding the information you need to put together a strong plan for the club.
Yeah, because let's be honest, if I had entitled this session, how to create a strategic plan for 5 years for your club, we would have five people watching right now.
Right.
But we didn't call it that. So, on purpose.
Yeah, and I think that it's important to know that vibrant clubs are really thinking about the next generation.
They are.
And I Absolutely. Think that's, you know, so as we're looking for the next generation, we got to be thinking it's not just our year. It's what is our club going to look like 5, 10, 15 years out? And how is it going to be vibrant and change enough during that time frame to make an impact still in the community that's in? Because, you know, we have clubs that are 100 years old and they're not doing the same things they were doing 100 years ago. And I think that that's important that good point. Good point. Sorry. We're hoping, you know, that they are changing with the community. And if they're not, we are hoping that this will help them.
Yeah, indeed. Indeed. And if not, we'll wait to hear from you when the Pony Express arrives. We're happy to get that feedback from you when that happens. Beth, are we ready to move on to our next session? Oh, we actually have a 5 minute break. So let's do a 5 minute break. We'll come back. So we're going to count down 5 minutes and we'll see you very, very soon.
There'll be a counter on your screen so you can see the 5 minutes counting down.
So, Bill, how did the interviews go?
Well, let's just say I heard some word usage that I hadn't heard in a Rotary setting before. It was pretty interesting.
Well, you know, I love the same. And I love good singing, but sometimes we struggle on what to sing, and then we don't sound so good.
I remember this time that Sarah brought one of her friends to our meeting, and I overheard her saying that she'd never heard the song Old Susanna before. You know, the song was written in 1846 by Stephen Foster for his men's social club. What are we doing here?
Sometimes I don't feel like I'm part of the club because I'm Jewish. I know we're not a religious organization, but then we have a Christmas party. Why isn't it a Hanukkah party? I sometimes feel like we should celebrate either no religious holidays or all the religious holidays. I just think we should be more inclusive of everybody.
And shrimp, I gotta tell you, I got a feeling about shrimp. It's gonna be big.
You know what really gets to me is when, like, we have a guest at the table and everybody talks around him like they're not even there. I mean, even I have a hard time getting a conversation going once in a while, but it does become uncomfortable, and I can't imagine how they feel.
I remember this. No, wait. Yeah. I remember this new member a couple of years ago. Sat at a table. Poor guy sat at a table all by himself. Nobody sat with him. He was inducted that day. I wish I could remember his name.
Phil, that was me.
Oh. Wow.
You're still here.
How many nonprofits are we allowed to come here to speak to us? They come in here and all they want is money, money, money. They hit us up for that. Anything worse than politicians. I remember this one time we had this Rotarian. He just joined the club and he was running for city council. He won the election and he quit Rotary the next day. So all I'm saying is we need better programs and we need better speakers.
I think we try, but we can't get our act together. Like, we'll have a greeter at a meeting, but as soon as that greeter sees somebody they know, they're off to the bar. Or they just say hi and there's no engagement, there's no conversation after. So no connection, no engagement. Just saying hi doesn't make you friendly.
I have just one word, shrimp.
I know for a fact that my wife does not like coming to Rotary functions, and I know other partners feel the same way. How can we ever grow our membership if we are not welcoming and inclusive?
Club clicks makes it really hard to fit in. One of the biggest ones, and it's getting worse, is the old guys click, the old guys table. Used to be one, now it's two. And if you sit at one of their tables, they let you know it.
Bill, are you sure you want to be the membership chair? Because the social chair is way more fun.
Okay, so the interviews went pretty well?
Yeah, you could say that. I mean, it's just the same stuff we hear over and over again. But we dismiss those members because we call them complainers.
But you know, they're not wrong. How can we legitimize what they're saying after we've been calling them names for so long?
You know, the way I see it, we're going to have to lead a change in culture in our club. And I think it's going to have to be us. Because if not us, then who?
Sarah, it's so good to talk to you. You know, we have a very unique group of kids. They have abandonment issues. They need mentors. The main thing is, I just don't want them to experience more disappointment like they've already been experiencing.
Yeah, Sydney, I'm leading a change in our club with others who believe that we need to focus more on sustaining projects rather than one and done projects.
Sustaining? Tell me more about sustainability.
Well, to me, sustainability has as much to do with the problem as it does the solution. In society, we have certain problems that will never go away. There will always be kids who need adopting. There will always be people who face hunger. And there will always be young people who need mentorship due to their home situation. Because these problems are perpetual, the response must be long term.
Yeah, but you guys have older people. Your numbers are down. I mean, sometimes I look around and you don't have a whole bunch of people helping you. Really, what are you going to do to keep up the energy to keep up with our kids?
Well, we're going to start by getting involved with our other local Rotary clubs, the breakfast and the evening clubs, to join with us and expand our resources.
That sounds good. Tell me more about that.
We will also be bringing in new members already volunteering in your program. I have two friends at work, Adam and Luana, who volunteer at your center and are considering membership in our club right now.
That would be awesome. I'll tell you what, if you get them to join, you can count me in too.
You're on.
Cool.
Thanks so much for meeting with us today. So, first of all, how did you guys meet?
Well, Luana and I met Sarah at work. She was the new kid and we felt sorry for her.
Yeah, work was tough. There, we just kind of bonded over pizza and late nights and got the work done. That's when you started telling me stories of the kids you work with at the youth center. I don't think it was even a week before I was out there helping out. I think that's when we really became good friends.
So Adam, how did you get involved with the youth center?
Well, my family was always big on the community and helping to make our community a better place. I was taught at a really young age to give back. And what I never really expected was how much I would get out of the experiences personally.
Yeah, he'd just go on and on about the kids he was helping out, and I wanted to help out too, so that's how I got involved.
So is that how you got involved, Sarah?
Yeah, after being asked to help out at the center, I was just hooked, and I realized that more good role models is what the center needs. They really can't have enough.
You see, Sarah gets it, and when the kids in the community see that people see them, I mean really see them, it makes a difference. It makes them feel like they really matter.
You know, Bill, can I be honest with you?
I know the center really appreciates all the grant money that the club raises for them, but what would really make a big impact mm-hmm. would be if we actually got members out there to help out with them.
All right, well, Adam, Luana, let me propose something to you. Now, would you guys agree that getting people to work on a project has as much to do with the people that are working on the project as it does the project itself?
Well, sure. That's how I got Luana and Sarah to help out.
That's my point exactly. So our mission in the club is to get more members involved in helping out. And the best way to do that is to get people like you folks to step up and join us and be leaders.
I don't know if I really see myself as a leader.
That's what I said before my dad made me join the club. But what I found afterward was a bunch of people who encouraged me to lead and then supported me when I did. These people won't let you fail.
Okay, so I'm asking, are you guys up to the challenge? Will you join our club and help make this youth center project more sustainable and bigger than ever?
I love it. I'm in. It seems like a great way to leverage what I'm already doing. Plus, it's easier for me to recruit people.
I mean, I'd love to join, but I have kids, so during the summer months, I wouldn't be able to go to the meetings.
Oh, you can bring them. Christina brings her kids all the time, and honestly, the club's gotten used to it. It's really no big deal.
Oh, well, I guess I'm in then.
Well, this is awesome, and I have a surprise for you guys. I spoke with Sydney recently, and he said that if you guys joined, then he'd be in too. So now we've got four of us.
You know what I call that? A great start. Let's go.
Fantastic. All right, guys, so this is the process. We have a what we call a member club.
So, Mike, sometimes when you're in surveys, you get to hear things that you might not have expected, but yet it's really helpful to the club. Tell us about this segment.
It's interesting. You know, we kind of iterated on the survey part, mm-hmm. and what we did was we said, hey, why don't we just interview some members? Some members are not going to want to fill out that survey. So we went about interviewing them and said, mm-hmm. tell me how you really feel, right? And in this case, you got to see it because we actually, you know, recorded them. But in a lot of cases, this would be an opportunity to take notes. If you really want to know, find everybody who didn't fill out the survey and talk to them one-on-one. Take notes. And leave it at that. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of why we put this section here. So it was one, a vehicle for that. Two, it was a vehicle for getting some things said that I think we all know need to be said. And I bet you that at least one of those is how a member feels in your club. Would you not agree?
Yeah, about shrimp, right?
Yeah. Gotta have shrimp.
Well, I think, yeah, it's important. You know, we are a club of friends and people that like to get together and talk. And sometimes we forget about that. You know, how often does a club just send out emails or the newsletter mm-hmm. and wait for response? Or even, you know, at a meeting, just pass around the sign-up sheet without talking to the members. And I think that's the other hidden thing in here is, you know, people who join Rotary for those friendships, and you gotta talk to them, especially, you know, in today's world. I think it's even more important. You know, you have some members that are maybe kind of disconnecting, and what are you doing to reach out? If you're just sending them an invite to your Zoom meeting, or you're just sending them the newsletter, is that what they're used to of Rotary, and is that what they want from Rotary? So maybe it's time that you pick up the phone and call them or have some personal conversations with them. I think that's a thing that we just overlook too often.
Well, yeah, and it's in survey after survey after survey, always it's in the high 30s. People want the friendship. The friendships, the communication, right. The bonding, that is why they stay in Rotary, and that's mm-hmm. why they're here. But that still leaves 64. Yeah, I did say I'm an accountant. 64% is other things, right? And I think being heard is a big part of that. Mm-hmm. Whatever that other percentage is made up of, being heard and knowing that you care enough to ask, and that if they do feel strongly about something, that hey, you know what, we'll take a look at that. I mean, my good buddy John Pally, JP, had some great comments in there. And I think it's those were hard to face from some of us because we feel, you know, gosh darn it, it's going to be a Christmas party. Okay, but you do realize we do have other people and other, you know, face
that are in because we are agnostic.
Right.
And so we can't really belittle that anymore and say, okay, fine, it's a holiday party. We got to be serious about that now. I really feel strongly about that because somebody may feel like, okay, I don't belong here. I'm just not going to come. And I face that with my company. My previous company, I had one of my employees was a Jehovah's Witness and didn't celebrate Christmas. And we have Christmas things. And because of her faith, she didn't do that. So she got additional dispensation for doing something on her own. And doing something her way. And so I think that just knowing that even though she was one out of 174 employees, she felt better about that because we recognized that. And we said, look, we really need to be respectful of everybody. And so
I think it also, when you look at it from a sales standpoint and being a salesperson, it opens up your markets. Just think about that. If we took any market and say we, you know, as we were at one time, just a men, organization for men, that means we just cut off 50% of the population that kids that you can market to bring into your club. And anytime we isolate people or take things off the plate that they feel they're uncomfortable with, we may be getting rid of a group of people. So just think about that. It just opens up the market, your ability to market to more people if you are more inclusive.
True. You know, there is one overriding theme of this whole session four, and it's really talking to people and communicating, right? We communicated with all the members of our club and we kind of got what they were feeling about certain things. And then Sarah reached out to Sydney and said, hey, I want to talk to you about, you know, what we're going to do here. She didn't send an email. She didn't send a check with a little note in it saying we really should do some stuff together. She went out there, talked with him and heard his concerns. And then, you know what? And understood them and then responded in kind and really said, you know, I understand what I need to do here and I get it. And so we're going to do this. We're going to work together and do this. And it resonated with him. Mm-hmm. And then she followed that up, you know, with Bill in talking with Luana and Adam. Right. Because, you know, you'll notice and your third question on your discussion book here is, you know, last time you asked somebody to join the club, you just go, so what did you think about Rotary? You want to join Rotary? Can we do Rotary? Can you join? I got a form right here.
I signed right here, right?
Whoa. Right. You know, why don't we get to know these people? And I know we got to know these people in 3.5 minutes, but at least shows you, you know what? Let's have a discussion. You know, let's talk about, you know, how did you meet? Why are you involved with this? Find some common ground. Mm-hmm. And I think if you look for the common ground, a lot of times you'll get a good result because they'll see it. Mm-hmm. Or almost you don't really even need to ask. But, you know, the ask is kind of important, too. You know, sometimes it's like, come on. Yeah. We want you. I want you. And they want to hear that. They oh, you want me? You're already doing this? This is great. And I think that at least from my perspective, you know, I've had very good results from that when I've brought people into the organization in that regard. Right. How about
well,
you?
I think there's another important part about that is where if you do that and you get to know the people, you're bringing in the right people.
Right.
And you're getting people that are going to do it. One thing I've never been afraid of, and this is in my sales career, I never want to sell something to somebody that is going to be an unhappy customer. You know, if it doesn't fit their needs and I push it onto them, they're going to be unhappy and they're going to probably cause me more issues than not. Same in Rotary. If you bring in somebody that really wants to do projects for animals and your club does nothing for that, is that a good fit? Mm-hmm. They're probably better off finding an organization that fits that need and that desire than joining Rotary. There's plenty of people that want to do the same thing your club's doing. You just need to find them and explain to them what we're doing. And if they're excited about it, they're going to be great members instead of having one that joins and 3 months later leaves the club.
Absolutely. And you know what, Ray? We've seen statistics about that being in the membership. I know you did membership director for 3 years before you were DG. And we learned that, you know what, Rotary has a problem. We get people to join and then they're out 18 months. And, you know, you're seeing a high percentage of turnover early on because they're not connecting. They're not engaged. And maybe it wasn't the right fit. It wasn't that we just didn't do something right. It could be that. But it could also be they just, you know, we think vetting them means that we're looking that they're not a felon. That's not vetting. The other side of vetting is making sure that this is something that is going to be part of their A time, part of the things that thing that they love to do and they're going to want to do. And then it'll help with the engagement because they'll
row a little bit harder on their side to get engaged because right. it's something they want, right?
And I think that, again, by knowing them, you can get them doing the things in the club that they wanted to do in the first place, too. So even those people that have those common synergies, again, they may not be necessarily wanting to engage in an international project. Maybe just wanting to do something local. Or it could be the opposite way around. But if you don't know that and you push them into one of those other areas, they go, well, this is not really what I thought it was. So if you really get to know them first, you can direct them to the place that they're going to get satisfaction almost immediately.
Agreed. Beth, we have somebody on the line.
Yeah, someone asks, has any Rotary Club been effective at partnering with our new partner, Toastmasters?
Our new international partner, Toastmasters.
Well,
one that helps you speak properly.
Obviously, we've never gone. I know that we have Toastmaster members in it, and I know that the Toastmasters work really close with the Citrus Heights Club. I would reach out to them if you're looking for some stuff, because they've had a relationship. A lot of their members have been part of Toastmasters for a lot of years. So, but other than that, I don't know of any new relationships. Do you, Brett?
I do not know of any new relationship yeah. with no. the district.
You know, I think that a lot of times some people are afraid to lead an organization because they have stage fright. They have that. I don't know if I'm speaking right. I don't know if I'm communicating well. And I think that that's one of the benefits of having this partnership now is that resource is available. And so I think if you know that you have a lot of people that you would love to be leaders in your club, but they're not going to get in front of an audience because they're really self-conscious about the way they speak, I think maybe that's where you as a leader that is not afraid of that identifies that and then goes out and brings that resource in, because they most likely will not do it for themselves. Right. You saw in session three, the session right before this one, where Bill was mentoring Sarah. It's one of the things we neglected to talk about after that session, is that mentorship is so vital to our organization. And there's a way, in my mind, there's a way to do it that really promotes people feeling like they're included and feeling like they're not slighted in any way, you know what I mean? Or they're not good enough. Everybody's got talents, but everybody needs help and in different areas. Some people just need to know when to shut up.
Mike.
Yeah. Hold on. but I think we all have the opportunity.
Nobody has leaders.
We have it owed to the organization to mentor. Right. And I think that that's something that we all should kind of own and try to take on.
Yeah, 100% agree. And I mean, I came into Rotary at 26 and, you know, was given leadership positions that they should not have given this 26-year-old kid. And yet the leaders of that club, and they were the community leaders, were not going to let this kid fail. And they mentored me and kept me going and got me through those first few years, helping me every step of the way to make sure that I would succeed. And that really changed my life for the rest of my life.
Yeah, and Sarah said that in this last session. You know, right. She was there because LaWanna was a little bit afraid about being a leader. And Sarah, one peer talking to another said, look, these people didn't let me fail.
Right.
And I think that's one of the big selling points of our organization is that we don't. Or at least we shouldn't, right?
Right. Well, and I think that if it's not in your presentation to a prospective member, it should be. Right. But you have to remember, if you're going to use that as a selling point, you should also be practicing that.
Yep.
And I think that's sometimes we forget about that. And we just expect that everybody that comes in Rotary is automatically a leader. And then we can't understand when they are uncomfortable with portions of it.
Right. Your club may have more leaders than you actually know. And again, a lot of this, how do you cultivate them?
Right.
Yep. You know, are you identifying them? Are you looking at people? Because a lot of times it can be a great leader can be just someone who's passionate about one thing that never even thought about leading. But, you know, they love the organization. They love what it does. And I think if they feel supported and safe, that is when you're going to find that your club might have more leaders than you thought you did.
Well, and I think it's important you realize that they might be uncomfortable about things that you're not. And a perfect example in some of the segments was, you know, how can you not all want to sing in tune every song every day? You know, you might find that's, you know, a little bit of conflict where I come from.
Yeah.
But the reality is,
it's every day. I know it's like watching a Disney film with little animated birds tweeting around. We don't have that.
Right.
We don't have that in my house.
Right. Yes, as the only non-musician, it's difficult at times. But I think that we have to be willing to accept those what our club needs and what they want. And I think the other thing is that we have to give viable options. And I think, you know, you can have music without singing.
Absolutely.
And I think that's something that we have to make sure that we are able to do and using the tech to allow that so that we give people who like it a part of it. And yet we don't have to embarrass those who can't sing, like
exactly.
me.
Exactly. And you're foreshadowing a bit into session five. So a little bit of what's to come. So I like that. But yeah, I think, you know, leadership is a big part of a vibrant club. I think that's kind of, and you really can't lead without communicating.
Right.
And so that, if there's a message to take from this session, those are two big pieces to pull from this. So Ray, any last thoughts before we move on?
Well, I think that, you know, we've really hit the points, but I think that that's one thing you may look at your club structure is, mm-hmm. you know, how are you helping people get it? You know, we are also a vocational club and, you know, I have to tell you, I've stretched a lot through my Rotary career, not just being president of my club or district governor, but I've had people there that have encouraged me to take chances, take risks on stuff that I wasn't comfortable with. And I believe that's made me a better leader and also, you know, just a better person all the way around. Right. So think of that. If people want those opportunities or are willing to do those, if you encourage them, guess they're going to get a lot more out of Rotary, just not the great community service we do or the other things. They'll become better people all the way around.
And right. Ray, if you didn't become the person that you have become, I wouldn't have been pushed into doing all this. So thank you.
You're welcome.
I would become quite a motivator.
And I wouldn't be sitting in the middle of you two.
Awesome. So I think we can move on to session four, talking about the plan.
How about this?
you want to bring the
I was foreshadowing so that you would get it right. I mean,
I'm not going back and die. Here we go.
And so, to conclude my remarks, our leadership team has put in quite a lot of time developing a plan to address all the issues I just mentioned. I know that some of you may have a hard time with this plan, as it proposes some changes. However, I would ask that you try to keep an open mind after each leader presents their plan. To start, here is my daughter, Sarah, to go over the plan for community service.
Hi, everyone. I'll be honest with you, I was a bit nervous when taking on this challenge because I was initially voluntold to do this. However, the past few weeks have shown me that it is possible to find worthy projects within our community and people that are willing to work on them. So this whole process started with a community assessment where I went out and visited some local nonprofits and community leaders to get their opinions on where help is needed and to determine exactly what type of help they're looking for. As I found out, there are over 400 nonprofits within our local area. I had to narrow my focus down with some criteria. And the criteria is as follows. Have we helped this charity in the past? Did community leadership indicate this was a need in the community? Does it involve children or seniors? Could we recruit other people to join in? And would this charity also be a good partner for a club? In doing so, I was able to narrow my focus down to just a few projects, which I then put in the club survey to see what you guys wanted to do. The result? We are going to start participating in the Youth Center Mentorship Program. Here are the reasons why we chose this program. One, we have funded it in the past with grant money, and it has even been a district grant in the past using the Rotary Foundation money. Two, I have interviewed the executive director, and he is supportive of a sustained effort by our club in this program. Three, our club usually likes programs that we continue year after year. Four, this project was the highest rated in our survey, just beating out Abacuses for Adolescents. Sorry, Uncle John. And five, we will be providing funds to improve the mentoring facilities, which will be adorned with the new Rotary branding. And six, we have members with the types of backgrounds to be good mentors. And on a personal note, I have been involved with the center for a year now, and recently the people that got me involved will be joining our club as members next month, and I just have to say I am thrilled to have them. I'm recommending that we seek professional help to help get the overhang fixed. We'll use this year's DDF funds from the Rotary Foundation for this project as it will focus on infrastructure.
So these are our projects planned for next year. I think that they'll bring us positive visibility in the community, attract members, achieve current member engagement and satisfaction, and they'll be a beneficiary for our annual fundraiser. Are there any questions?
I have a question. Actually, it's more of a comment than a question. I'm putting my abacus away forever. I think this is a great plan. It's going to give me a chance to teach accounting to some of these students. And I'm really looking forward to it.
Thanks, Uncle John.
So what kind of time commitment are we looking for?
Great question. We're looking at an hour a week. We're asking that you commit to that for the full Rotary year. And if you can't make it, we will have members who have agreed to fill in for you if needed. The point is, we need to show up and not let these kids down.
Don't we need to get background checks for this program?
Yes. The center has a process for that using LifeScan. Everyone who volunteers will need to comply with that. And in addition, our Rotary district requires us to get the club certified in youth protection. So we'll be doing that at a meeting very soon. Thank you.
Thanks, Sarah. You are my favorite daughter again. Next up, our fundraising chair, Jimmy.
Thanks, Hank. As I agreed to be the fundraising chair this year for Hank's year. Because of how the survey came out, we're all on board on updating our fundraiser this year, the crab feed, with special guest star, Mr. Shrimp. In addition, I spoke with Sarah, and we're going to propose that the Youth Center become our major beneficiary of the crab feed this year. As part of the partnership, the kids will be our servers and bussers, and they will talk about the program to the participants. And we're going to give them all the tips for their activities as well. The executive director, Sydney, will also work with us to bring new people to our event. I'm excited. Any questions?
Yeah, hey, Jimmy, where can I get a hat like that?
If you sign up to be put on the committee, you can get one too. Sign up now.
Thanks, Jimmy. I'm really excited about getting my shrimp on. Next up, we've got Jess, who's going to give us our marketing and branding plans for the year. Jess!
Hi, guys. So, okay, as you can see, I have a lot of Rotary gear, official Rotary gear. I am decked out in the official brand because our theme this year is visibility. I have noticed that in the past, we have a tendency to have really only former presidents that have any gear at all. And I wanted to try and change that. So in an effort to get everybody access to the stuff that they can wear and flaunt our Rotary brand, I have invited my good friend Val Niebust from Promote Me to come and join us to show off some of the amazing stuff that she has here. She's got Rotary pins and shirts and hats and the whole shebang. So we definitely want to check out all of Val's stuff. Val became an official provider of Rotary gear about 10 years ago when she became a member of Rotary. So we definitely want to give her a good shout out and wear that gear with the official Rotary brand. That's important. Next, we are going to make a point of promoting everything we do on our website and on Facebook. This means before the event happens, during the event, and after the event. We really need to make sure people know what we're doing, why we're doing it, and then they will want to join us. They will want to become members and support us. They have to know what it is we do, what we stand for in order to do that. And lastly, we will be live streaming all of our meetings using Facebook Live. I know this is going to make some of you a little nervous, but I've spoken with our club service chair, and well, we have some exciting things coming. I don't want to steal his thunder. So any questions?
I have a question. We have a lot of old signs with the old logo on it. What do we do with those?
Oh, that's a great question. I'm so glad you asked. So Val's going to help us update those. And so if you have any of those old signs, you can just bring them to me and I will make sure that we get those cleared up for you. We'll get them all updated with the new brand. Okay.
Thanks, Jeff. Next up, our membership chair, Bill.
Hello, everyone. So as I stand before you, our efforts have already brought in three new members.
We're going to be inducting Sydney, Adam, and Luana next month. And this is all a result of our efforts with the community and our first community outreach project. All right. These new members came to us by engaging with the community. All right. And this is what we need to keep doing in the future. Our goal is to increase by a net of 3 new members. You might think, well, we're already done. We've got our 3 new members, but that isn't the case. History has shown that we lose an average of 5 members each and every year. So we're going to need some real efforts to try to pick up and make up for those losses that we anticipate. But I think with what we're doing out in the community and with our efforts in marketing, I think we may only lose 3 members this year. And if we do, that'll be a lot easier to attain our goal of a net of 5 new members. All right. So what do we need to do to achieve this and hang on to the members we have? Well, one, I think we need to be truly friendly and engage with the community and our fellow members. Second, I think we need to provide an avenue for community members to gain visibility into our club and what we're doing, and then give them a way to contact us and learn about us and then possibly join. I think if we do that and we have fun and people see that we're having fun, I think we will have people want to join our club. So are there any questions?
I have a question. So I am not very good about asking people to join our club. What can I do?
Introduce them to me. We can sit down with that prospective member, make them feel comfortable, and find out if the club's a good fit for them. Anybody else?
Bill, I'm uncomfortable even talking about Rotary with other people.
Well, if you're uncomfortable talking about Rotary, then talk about something else. Talk about what we're doing in Rotary, not necessarily about Rotary, but talk about what we're doing, the community projects that we do, possibly our project at the youth center. Try that approach. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Bill. So here's the part that I am most concerned with. I think you all know that I am no entertainer. Thank you for being honest. This club really fulfilled the 4-way test there. But it was very clear that these meetings need to change. So as a group, we all met and came up with some bunch of suggestions of things that we can do. And here to tell you about them is Rich.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to thank Hank for asking me to chair our club service and start the process of changing our meetings for the better. So some things that came out of the survey we discussed were the following. Number one, we like music, but we don't necessarily feel comfortable singing. Number two, we like positive, inspirational thoughts and quotes that avoid offending anyone from any specific group. Number three, we like visuals, like videos and PowerPoints, because they are more engaging. Number four, we want speakers that educate us, not talk at us. We like updates from the city officials about current events, like sports figures, health professionals, teachers, travel, etc. Number five, we want to know about our fellow members and their vocations. Number six, we want to know about the good things and the challenges of our fellow members, if they want to share them. Number seven, we want updates on our projects and how we are doing. We're going to follow this list and invest in some tech equipment so that we can make our meetings fun and interesting, so that you will feel good about coming to every meeting and bringing some other prospective members with you. Our meetings will also be available online with Facebook Live, which means we will really have to make sure we watch what we say and do, but I think it's worth it. Are there any questions?
Are we still going to have themed events?
Yes, but with 3 distinct differences from the past. Number one, all of our meetings and events are open to all guests. They will not be specifically designated as couple events or members-only events. Number two, all of our events will not reference any religious holidays. And three, unless designated due to content or alcohol, all events will welcome families. If there's nothing else, we'll see you all at the next meeting.
Thanks, Rich. And there you have it. The plan is in place and we're off to the races. This is going to be a fluid situation, and we're going to need your feedback all year, everybody, to make sure that this plan succeeds. So look forward to a great year. And with that, this meeting is adjourned.
Hi, guys, and welcome back.
So while we were all watching that last session and shuffling our equipment, we had a couple questions and comments come through. One that had to do, one came from a younger member of our district. And this person asked why a younger person wasn't involved in the making of this. Well, actually, there was. Beth actually was in the writing room as we first premiered the script to Brent and got through it and provided a lot of input to make sure that we were trying to cover all age groups. Although that it must be told that, you know, us oldies are the ones causing all the problems. Right. So if they think that it's skewed a little more heavily towards that side, well, we're causing all the problems. You're going to be part of the solution. So hopefully they're listening out, you're listening to this, and the people in your club are listening to this as well, and will hear you out. The second comment was from Dave. Dave commented in. He says, I thought there were going to be sacks. Well, Dave, there are. This is an old fashioned. And it's delicious, right?
Thanks, Mike. So in your workbook, we also have a couple guides on building a plan and also how to look at the membership portion of a planning session. In this video, we only show kind of the results of the plan. So some of the questions may come up, you know, was it written? I think it's important that all plans are written and shared. So it shouldn't have been just shared at a meeting. It should have been available to all the members to look at and read and give their input.
Actually, Ray, that's a good point that you make that. When we actually were filming this, these plans were so long, you actually can see that at the podium, each of the chairs, directors, were actually reading their plan. That was actually intentional. It also helped with the actors, but it was intentional. So you can see that they actually had the plan written down, that it was specific, and it is a derivative of everything that's happened in the previous four sessions, correct? Mm-hmm.
That is correct. And that's something I think that we sometimes forget. You know, I know that when I was president, I built almost all of the plan and then asked for some input. Well, that doesn't always work because, you know, I didn't know everything that needed to be done or all the different things, and I didn't have all the necessary tools at that time to do it. But once we started getting the input, we started adjusting the plan. And I think that's another reason why you have that written plan, so that you can have those discussions and adjust, because some of the ideas may not work. And then you have to review it through time too, because, you know, you may have to think you have the greatest idea in the world and you go and do it and it doesn't work.
So there, now we know who the inspiration for Hank was. Thanks, Ray. You let the cat out of the bag.
Well, I just want to say, I mean, what I loved about this segment is you guys really played Hank well, because Hank is not really the planner here. Ooh. And, you know, in my life, I know that's not my skill set, but you bring the people around you that can do that and they can plan and help you get through that plan. And so as president, your job is not to do it all. Your job is to bring really smart people on your board and then let them do their job. And man, Hank was doing that perfectly.
Well, Hank, I think, emulates what we try to refer to here as the servant leader.
Yeah.
Right? He gets the right people, he finds that, and then he says, look, I'm here to support you. I'm just here to kind of, you know, mm-hmm. provide a nice, safe playing field for you. And then if you need help, I'm here to help you and get you what you need. Right. And I think Hank grew into that extraordinarily well. Absolutely. Right.
Well, and I think what you see is you see that his chairs had buy-in.
Right.
You know, you could tell that they were part of the solution. And if you look at the previous sessions, they answered a lot of the issues that had come up previously and showed how those solutions were going to be implemented to make those changes. I think all clubs are different. So what your set of issues, positive or negative, could be totally different than this video. But if you recognize them and you have your leadership and your members rally around and let you know what needs to be changed, then you can put together a plan that, again, is going to buy in and going right back to engagement.
True. And how great it is to be a member of that club now, having gone through all those interviews, the survey and whatnot, and then you watch the team get up there and present the plan.
They listen
to me. Right. Oh, my, that was my comment, right?
Yep.
And you talk about engagement. You know, you don't necessarily see it, hear about it, but it's there. Because you just hooked whoever gave you that comment and thought it was going to fall on deaf ears. There it was. Okay. And that kind of relates back even to the first comment we kicked off this discussion with, is the same thing. You know, that person is out there saying, hey, I got some ideas. I know I'm young, but I got some pretty good ideas. Mm-hmm. And I bet they do. And they were you know, brave enough to speak out. And I'm hoping that that club appreciates that member and will work with that member to hear them out. Because I think they have a golden opportunity with that person to get younger, to get more people to come in, right? I smell a very big opportunity there.
Mm-hmm. And again, and in those situations, again, we can't emphasize enough that review of the plan throughout the year. So, you know, 3 months from now, don't take that written plan and put it on the shelf like a lot of small businesses do. You know, take the plan, put it on the shelf and say, I have a plan for my business. Hopefully it works. But you got to go back and review it. And did you miss something that you thought you needed to do? Or did it not work? Or is it working and we're going to build on it?
Or did something happen like COVID?
Yeah.
That never happened anyway.
That never happened before we have something change the planet, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, something like that. So is your plan flexible enough to be able to say, wow, now we have this in place. When everybody's communicating and there's a good flow, something like that happens and the adaptation is very swift.
Right.
Right? And we've seen clubs in our district adapt very swiftly to working online, to having the meetings broadcast and things like that. And other clubs are a little slower. So that could be an indication there of, do I have things working? Did everybody come to play and to try to help through this problem that we're having? And do we have that transition quickly? Or do we struggle with that? And again, that's one of those things where you've got to air that,
right?
You know, because that's the only way it's going to get better.
And remember, if you have that written plan, you can also give it to the new members that come in, because they may have some great ideas. They may have a totally different take on what you're doing, and it may be better.
Right.
Or it might not. But it could be better.
But
the thing is, you listen and you share. And that's the big thing. That's your point, right? Right, that you share the information.
Well, and I think having that written plan really helps with your succession planning.
Oh, yeah.
Because the next team says, okay, this was the plan, and they tweak it or guide it further and, you know, put their own personal
spin on it. Right.
But it allows it to be that starting point, and your club continues on doing good things while allowing it to change and be, you know, somewhat personable to the leadership the year and decade that it's there.
Yeah. And we joke up here, we have fun with each other because we've kind of grown into being risk takers a little bit, right? We're doing it. We've kind of drug Brent along to be a risk taker. But you know what? That's how you explore new things. That's how you find out that, ooh, wow, we're not going to do that again. Or things surface, right? But it's a constant evolution. I think that's the part about risk that people don't understand. They hear the word risk, and then it brings up fear. A lot of people say, I'm afraid to do that. But that is truly how we advance. And it's also how you grow as a person. When you take little risks and you do so in a safe environment, you can iterate and people will pick you up and you can move on.
Yeah, risks like that's FFF and amazing.
Yes.
That was a risk.
I still remember the first day that I heard that. Never forget that day. And now I'm wearing a shirt. Indeed. And I see Beth over there nodding about the first day she heard it.
More importantly, the first day her mother heard it.
Exactly. So, Ray, you did bring up, we do have it's sort of a sample planning guide here. This kind of is one that was used for this club, the club or the club of good intentions, right? Mm-hmm. So this was there. So once again, just like with the survey, don't just copy this, because this is not a recipe for success for your club, but it has the elements, mm-hmm. again, that they use. So these pieces are the pieces that can help you, but they aren't necessarily the exact verbiage and exact plans that you'll be using.
True. Right. And everything has to always be adjusted, because, you know, we have 37 clubs in this district. And no two are the same.
Right.
Nope.
Each of you, if you come down with your list of issues or good things you're doing, is going to be different than another club. So you have to adjust everything to make sure you do what's best for your club.
True. Absolutely. Beth, I think, do we have a question there?
Yeah. So someone says, if you do community outreach and then a club survey and find that maybe 75% of the members support a certain community outreach, what about the 25% that support a different or some that don't get enough support to pursue?
Well, having just been through an election season, I think we can all understand that if you can get a 75% number, that's a touchdown.
You're a win.
That is a win-win. But right, what does happen with that other 25%? I think that that's what you have to explore. If you know that 75% of the club is absolutely for something, boy, you've got support to get something done and have some real good participation. But you're right, that 25% should not be ignored because you don't want to isolate them or say that, well, you guys can just take a break this term and we'll see you next Rotary year. You got to engage them somehow. Ray, you have some ideas about how to engage them?
Well, I think that one of the things that we have to look at is I hope that most clubs don't do just one project a year. You know, in this example, yeah, we're focusing on one project because it's a change for the club. And so
no, there were two. The awning that fell down.
But that was a redo. But I think,
project.
You know, this is one of the reasons why, you know, a lot of times when we have discussions like this, we talk a lot about the foundation. But usually the foundation money that we get in a club handles our big project. But the way we can keep members engaged all year round is by having multiple projects. And those can be the ones that the other 25% want. And they may be smaller projects. They may be bigger projects. They may not be using DDF or things like that when you're doing it. But you can still get those done. And if you're doing a lot of projects, guess what? The community is going to notice, and you're going to have member engagement. And that's what we're really looking for.
Absolutely. So, yeah, so again, it's gets back to communication. It's all about communication. Are you talking with those members and are you making them feel like, you know what, I know we didn't select a project that you really were really passionate about or wanted to engage with, but you know, we do care about you and you know what, I'd like to work with you. And that's where a good someone like Sarah in our in our video
absolutely.
Would come out and say, you know what, guys, I really care about things that you want to do too. Is there something that you guys want to start up now? Do I have a leader for this that can pick up what you guys might want to work on? And again, that's how the wheel spins, right?
And guess what? That 25% might become 50%.
It might.
I think one other thing, I think we're talking about community service projects right now, but it's also the other things you do.
Right.
Your socials, your club meetings, are they capturing the things that 25% or whatever that smaller percentage of people are looking for? If you're having socials that are only, are things that only a certain percentage of your club wants to do, you could be leaving out people and they may get disengaged. So you always should be looking at this and saying, how can we fit in things that is going to bring in different people? Because there's going to be different things
right.
that are going to motivate different people.
Well, so well said, Ray. You know, in a club that I know of in our district, as a group of people that has, you know, some issues sometimes with being able to do physical service or do certain things and things that they just aren't really excited about, but they love their cigars and cards. And so, and they have that sort of fellowship within the club. And again, we can't forget that Rotary, you know, again, time and time again, 36% of the people here are there for that friendship, that fellowship. And it could be that that's really why these people are here. And they may be just fine with that. You know, they may say, you know what, as long as I can keep rolling along and have this fellowship and have this friendship and meet every week and that sort of thing, that's fine for me. I'm getting value out of it. I am engaged in this way. Mm-hmm. And then maybe someday it comes along where they do all of a sudden say, you know what, I've got something. You know, I'm passionate about, you know, Alzheimer's research or whatever, or diabetes or whatever it is, or hunger. And the next thing you know,
yeah.
Because again, like Brent, you've said time and time again, this is a marathon, not a sprint,
right?
We're talking, we're a 105-year organization, and we hope to go for another 100 years. That's a long stretch, mm-hmm. and we just need to continue to do things that can perpetuate
yep.
the things that we do and what we offer to our members.
Yep, I agree.
And I have to say, it's 115, but that's okay.
My numbers are all off, right?
and I'm a sales guy. I'm not an accountant.
Unbelievable. Beth, do we have any other questions there? Well, why don't we just...
Well, before we go,
oh, okay.
I just want to give a shout out to Pete Schroeder. Yes, I'll give you acting lessons anytime you need them, Pete.
Actually, Ray was conducting little clinics as we were, you know, between scenes and between shoots. Ray was there kind of coaching the other actors on, you know, how to be very, very real. And I think, you know, Jimmy really shone through his very, very real as a character. All right. Well, hey, I'm sure you guys all want to see how it all turned out. We're going to flash forward a year and land on the end of the year for the Rotary Club of Good Intentions, Session 6. Here it comes.
Wow, we've had quite a year. We've had some successes, we've had some failures, but we learned a lot. I'm going to have the team come up now and tell you about our year. We're going to have the directors come up and our chair of membership and marketing. And now, my favorite daughter, who's led the community services, come on up, Sarah.
Thanks, Dad. You know, when I asked to take on the role of service chair, I had an idea of what I wanted to do, but it was really our community outreach that brought into focus what we needed to be doing. When we matched our community assessment with our member survey, we had a plan that we could feel confident in executing. I'll start with our project to fix / replace the awning disaster, and I call it a disaster because it was. We had actually planned to just hire professionals to replace the current awning and make it structurally sound, but what we ended up doing was something totally different. And for this, I have to give credit to Phil. Phil went out to arrange a time to have the awning replaced and spoke with the executive director of the facility. She said that she would prefer we just remove the awning altogether and that the grant monies be used to pour a concrete pad that could be used by the facility for gatherings and other community events.
If I may, we actually were able to use the executive director in a video for like promotion that we had her talking about how she was so appreciative that we listened to her and we actually provided her a facility that she really needed, an infrastructure that she needed for her facility. And what a difference that made. And I gotta say, it got us a lot of social traction. So the last time, our little issue with the awning, that got us 1,000 views. This time we had over 2,500 views and 100 shares. That's huge.
Thanks, Jess, for all of your help promoting that project. It really made all the difference. And no doubt, our mentor program that started this year was our biggest success. Though we only had 8 members dedicate themselves to the year-long project, all 8 will be continuing through next year. Our presence at the Youth Center has created quite a buzz, and participation by youth has increased exponentially during the year.
Sarah, no doubt, this project absolutely kicked off our membership efforts this year. We had the executive director join the club, and 2 other Youth Center volunteers join immediately after that. In addition, we had 2 additional people join the club during the year because of their involvement and because of our involvement in this project. This really added to our numbers and our diversity.
Yeah, and I really want to thank Sydney for giving us this great opportunity and believing that we could make a difference in his organization. And for joining our club, because I really like him and I'm glad he's here. Thanks again, everyone, for all of your support. Next up is Mr. Shrimp himself, Jimmy.
Okay, I told you the trip was going to be big, and it was. But without the help from the Youth Center, it wouldn't have been quite as good. Their support to the event really worked out. It wouldn't have been this great without them. Here's a couple of the facts. First, we had a 50% increase in attendance. Normally, we bring in an average of 200 people. This year, we had 300 people attend the crab feed. People say the best time they had was seeing the kids and talking with them. And the amazing part was that normally we make a net of $13,000, but this year we made $30,000. 50% going to the Youth Center, 50% going to our club foundation, which means that we made $15,000 or $2,000 more than we've made before. I call this a win-win.
And for the first time, we actually had membership inquiries at an event. How great is that?
That's incredible. You know, we were able to really do a lot to promote this event on our website, on social media, as well as on the Youth Center's website. And that made such a huge difference. And we got some earned media from the local TV and radio stations. And that really gave us some incredible exposure, drove a lot more traffic to our website, drove up the ticket sales like crazy, and increased how many sponsorships we got, which really helped feed into all of it. It was awesome.
I ain't gonna lie. It was a lot of hard work, more than in the past, but it was totally worth it with the results.
This is our biggest fundraiser ever. And I especially like to thank Rich, who will be coming up next, because he brought in a lot of those great sponsorships.
You know, it's great to see so many smiles in the club. I can't remember a time when there's been so much excitement. I'd like to thank everyone who contributed to help us get some sound and video equipment so that we could not only have more fun at our meetings, but also make it possible to broadcast our meetings on Facebook Live and have speakers from outside our local area speak to us via video conferencing. I truly had a lot of fun picking out music for us to listen to during our meetings, and I appreciate all of the suggestions given by the members. I think having all the different types of music added to the excitement of our meetings. In addition, I'm grateful for the referrals for speakers that a lot of you gave to me. It was easier to get them to speak if they could do so remotely, and our new equipment made that possible. I should point out that our most popular speakers were our own members giving vocational talks on what they do for a living. And it's been great to get to know each of you better. A big thanks to Jess for putting together the upcoming event slide we showed each week with the date, time, and location of all the upcoming meetings and events. Please keep those suggestions coming. I think we can do more to add fun to what we do during each hour that we spend together every week. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, and hey, guys, all these changes that Rich has put in place here, I mean, the impact of that has been incredible. We were only getting about 40% attendance at our meetings. We're now up to 70%. Thanks, Stacy, for getting me those numbers. I really appreciate it.
And Bill, I should also mention that in all the efforts we put into broadcasting the meetings and the events really brought in a lot of guests. I mean, we had an average of 5 guests per meeting this year. Last year, it was pretty much none. So yeah, thanks again, Stacy, for keeping track of those numbers.
Awesome. Hey, Jess. Can you stay here for a second? You know, I just want to give credit where credit's due. I mean, without Jess's efforts this year in posting all of our events online before, during, and after each event and meeting, we would not have had the results we had this year. I mean, we've had an amazing turnout. We're much more visible in the community, and our impact is much better known. And without you, that wouldn't have been possible. So thank you very much. So I guess it's my turn. So as your membership chair, I'd like to report this year did not work out like we had planned. We'd hoped to only lose 3 members and hopefully net 3 new members, but we ended up losing 5. I never wanted to think that we could lose members due to health issues, but this year we lost 2. As sad as that was, we also lost 3 great long-term members. They just didn't agree with the changes and decided to move on. But there's a brighter side. We gained 10 new members this year and had a net gain of 5. We are younger now and more diverse than we've been in our history. And I think we're more reflective of our community. I'm proud of this change, but I can in no way take credit for it all. This was truly a team effort, all the directors working together. It was truly everybody that you've heard from today. In addition, I'd like to thank Phil. Phil really stands out to me because he selflessly agreed to be our greeter all year long. Thank you, Phil. And so I guess, thanks for letting me have the last word. So, okay. Here goes. You know, I'm pleased with the progress we've made, but I think that we're far from being done. You know, we've had 10 straight years of membership losses, but this year we were up 5 people. That's up 10%. We are younger, more diverse, and definitely having more fun. We've learned, however, though, that some people can put Rotary ahead of their personal issues, and some people can't. But I'd like to think of John. John told me as we started on all of this that he didn't agree with any of the changes that we were making. But he knew that if we were going to survive, that we had to change. And I'd like to point out, John's still here. So where do we go from here?
Well, I got two words for you, review and revise. We're not done. We need to look at what worked this past year and what didn't, and how we can make things even better. We're done? No, not even close. I think we have a long way to go, but we're on the right track. We started a membership committee this last year that really helped me connect more with our prospective members. We had a person from the membership committee sit with prospective members at every meeting. That really helped them connect with our club and understand our customs and our cultures. That membership committee has also yielded your next membership director. And once again, I'd like to thank Phil for filling my role next year.
And I'd like to thank Stacy for agreeing to be my president-elect this year. Stacy will be your president next year. Congratulations.
It's hard to believe that a guy who couldn't even find a place to sit at the first meeting he attended is now going to be your president. But here I am. And I love the path that we're on. So thank you for your faith. Thank you for your support. And thank you for your hard work and continued hard work as we go into next year. This meeting is adjourned.
Wow, what a great review. I just really appreciate Hank, because the reality is he made sure that the people that told the story were the people that were leading in charge of what was happening. And I think that's so appropriate, that we as leaders need to step out of the way and let the people who we put in charge tell us about the amazing things they've done. What do you think, Mike?
Now, I can't agree with you more, Brett. And I love the part at the end where, you know, Hank just steps aside. I mean, it lets the succession happen at the end of the year and allows people to just say, look, here's everybody that was involved last year. It was great. I had my time, and I'm just part of the team. Right. And I think it really shows a good model for that transition. Mm-hmm. And Hank is great at that.
Yeah,
you know, he doesn't want to be out in front. There are people like that, and that's absolutely fine. And he just chose very well. He supported well, and you know, I think it's all in the results. I mean, don't you think so, Ray?
Yeah. One of the things I really liked is, you know, again, we were supposed to be a leadership organization, right, and we showed Hank getting people to take on leadership roles, mm-hmm, and he let them develop themselves as leaders. So now he has a whole bunch of leaders, and he even went back and looked at someone like Stacy and said, hey, you know what, you really wanted it? Let's let you step up and become a leader, instead of what they did at the beginning, if you remember, right, just kind of pushed her aside. And I think that's not what a leadership organization does. It actually is there to train and strengthen the leadership capabilities of people.
Well, and yeah, so all you clubs out there that have had secretaries and treasurers for the last decade, come on. I mean, if they really want to be doing it, that's great. But in this case, Stacy really wanted a shot. And it was great that, you know, I think Hank kind of went to Bill and said, Bill.
Yeah, I did.
You know, did you see that? Stacy really wants that. And I think that again, that succession, that planning, that the stuff that happens sometimes behind the scenes in conversations, right, allows great things to happen. And obviously, Stacy's a great choice. I mean, nobody knows more about the club than she does.
Right.
And actually, that's a true story as well, because do we have a camera?
We lost it.
We have still on.
Okay. All right. So I'm sorry we had a little technical glitch. That's right. But that's actually a story too, because that's how my wife got to be president of the Passport Club. She was the secretary for 2-3 years and then became president-elect and president, not thinking that, you know, she would be able to do it, but did a great job.
That's how I became president, you know, secretary, treasurer, and how do I get out of this job? You can become vice president. I am all in.
It's in the Roseville Club. They have that same thing happen.
Yeah, amazing how that works.
I can't do this other job anymore.
I think the other thing that is really important in Hank's club is that they really have a range of leadership. Mm-hmm. So they have from middle age to young. And so they're building a really good set of range of leaders that they can have varied views of the world, but they're coming all together for really common good for the community and their club.
Yeah, and like it's a fun little cutaway. We were all laughing at the cutaway of our good friend Jim Crowley, who's Phil in our video. But you know, it also shows there are little jobs that don't take a lot of time, but are so important, like being that greeter. Yep. And some of the steps up that as you can see, Phil was super excited type of person, and he was the perfect person for that. Mm-hmm. And then that excitement, that recognition, made him want to be actually head up membership, because for him now there was a structure and he felt like he was engaged again. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's different ways to engage all the different age groups. We have to embrace what all the members' needs are, from age 21, drinking age, all the way up to our octogenarians. So. Yeah.
And I think it really points out is, have we reached out to some of those members? You know, we joke throughout the videos about the old guys.
Yeah.
And you know what? Sometimes they're doing it because we forget to ask them. You know, we think that they've already done it all and they don't want to do it anymore. But if you ask them, maybe they do want to do it. Maybe they want to participate in anything. But you kind of find out what those things are, what their passion still is today. And then ask them, you know, a couple of years ago, we had a president of my club that went and talked to all those people at the table. And most of them hadn't actually done any work projects for a while. They're still contributing in a lot of different ways. But once you ask them, some of them took leadership roles in certain projects and they did an awesome job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think one of the things that really strikes through the sessions are that we're communicating.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the reality is they talked to lots of people and they got their club involved. And so often, you know, telling the story about, you know, we didn't do the awning, we did the slab. The reality is sometimes we just do it and we forget to tell anybody.
Yeah. Hey, we're going to fix that. We're sorry.
Right. You
know, stand out of the way.
Right.
We're going to rescue. And it was like, oh, great. Okay.
Yeah.
We'll just let you do what you're going to do. It's your money, I guess.
Right.
And again, we're just not listening and we're not communicating. Yeah. And listening is an incredibly important part of that communication process.
Well, and it's also communicating outside the club. I mean, now they're telling the story, not only to their own club members, but outside the club, which is helping Rotary to grow.
Right. Right. Again, it's that impact to the community.
Right. And I think that it's a really important message that we hit multiple times through this, but we can't forget it, is, you know, when you're doing your marketing, you got it out and tell people what you're going to do so they can join you and get excited about it. And it's not just the outside public, it's your members. Mm-hmm. If your members don't know you're going to do it, how can they participate?
Right.
And then when you're doing it, you know, broadcast it. Let people know that you're doing
it. We're here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, make sure you have stuff out there that shows that you did it, you had fun doing it, it worked well, and it was a benefit. If you do all three elements on all your different events, whether it's your fundraiser, whether it's community service, whether it's just your meeting, guess what? You're going to get more engagement from the community, and people are going to look and see what you're doing and say, you know, I want to be part of that.
Absolutely. You know, we are such a visual people, right? Yeah, I mean, especially through COVID, you know, what exploded during COVID? Zoom and Netflix. That doesn't tell you where we're at. All right? That's where we are. And so, you know, having visuals for people to see, you know, what you're planning on doing, what you're doing and what you've done, it really kind of gets them excited and saying, wow, I really feel like I was part of this journey with them. Huh, maybe I'll reach out and I'll inquire as to, you know, how does a person like me get to have fun with people like you? Mm-hmm. And again, that's how that whole process starts. You know, one of the things I really liked about this wrap up too, again, everybody's coming up, like you said, Brent, everybody's coming up and telling their own story. Mm-hmm. And so they kind of get to close the chapter on it. You know, you said what you were going to do and then you went did it. And then you got to actually say how it worked out. And I think that there's a lot of pride that goes into that. When you have leaders, there's a lot of pride in being able to go the full circle. So many presidents that I've seen just take, they call up their thank yous, right? And I'm guilty. You know, 10 years ago, that's what I did. They just blah, 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 PowerPoint, 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 and here's your little Rotary trinket and go back to your chair. And I think what Hank did was so much better. And then that just, no, I'm going to have the people who did this tell you the story. And it really helps too, because then the club sees all of those people as leaders. Yep. Any one of them could be the next president-elect. You don't know.
Right.
And I think that any one of them would then also have the support of the club.
Yep.
Because they've already seen them and that, I enjoyed watching Sarah up there give her presentation about how service went. She could be a great leader someday, probably even better than her dad.
You know, no doubt about it.
How life imitates art. Yeah. Or art imitates life.
Well, you know, I also like when Bill was doing his closing things that he didn't just talk about the positives. He talked about some areas that they need to work on. So it showed that the plan that they put in place wasn't a one and done, that it was something that they're going to build on. And I think that that's what we should all be looking for is, you know, look at our successes and look at the stuff where we struggled and how do we take those things and combine them and the next year have even a greater year.
Right. And I think it's important that, and I think Bill really did this great, but was, you know, get the club ready to change. Yeah. You know, be a club that, you know you're not going to look like you do 10 years from now and you're ready for change on a yearly basis. And I think that's just such a great, important thing for the club to understand.
Right. Yeah, it's like a working out or exercise. You know, the more you do it, the more it's just, well, I'm accustomed to doing this now. This is kind of how things are. So change is part of your culture.
Yep.
You have a much easier time just progressing.
Amen.
And making things happen. Yeah. Beth, we have a question.
Yeah. Someone says, when you live stream a regular weekly meeting, should those be open to the public? I can see a club service being open to the public to see what the club is doing for the community, but not sure about regular weekly meeting.
Ray, why don't you take that?
Yes. I will tell you that since I think the first week of COVID, our club, the Fair Oaks Club, has live streamed our videos and it's been available. We give passwords, we do it on Facebook Live. The interesting thing that's happening right now is we're getting people from all over the world watching our things. We have a regular person that every week watches us on Facebook Live from India. We've had people from Taipei. We've had people from all over the United States. And some of the questions that come back is how we're doing it, what are we doing? You know, because we're really trying to make these meetings engaging and fun. Isn't that what we want also our members to see? Part of that result is we've been bringing in a lot of new members. Most of the new members that we're bringing in to our club, I think we've brought in 6 or 7 this year. Most of them never came to a live meeting until they saw it. And they were always welcome. They're watching it. They saw the fun, the camaraderie, even though we weren't doing it, they're learning about the projects we're doing. They were invited to come to those projects that they felt comfortable doing that. But they said, I want to be part of this. So why would you hide that?
Yeah.
This would be my question.
Yeah. So, well, and here's another great thing. Being live streamed, I know Roseville Club's been live streaming as well, about as long as Fair Oaks Club has. And one of the great things about that is it makes you, and we even mentioned this in the video a little bit, it makes you think about watch what you say. And I don't need necessarily watch what you say in a John type of way.
Yeah,
right. I meant more of like PDG, DG, PP, DDF, da, 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 all these acronyms that we have, all of this rotary speak that we do can tend to alienate guests or new members. Like, oh, you guys are just one giant click. Ooh, you got the whole secret handshake. You know, and having to be open like that, you tend to be a little more transparent. You tend to be a little more, you know, inclusive and communicative about really what you're doing without a lot of code names and whatnot, and you tend to be more real. And I think that is what people that are experiencing your club meetings are experiencing, right? Would you say?
I agree, but I will give you a downside. You have to make your meetings interesting.
Yep.
You know, and it's true and live or not, but if you don't interact with the people out there. You know, we've done videos, we've done polls and stuff like that. And you have to have an entertainment value. So, you know, we're still using our PowerPoint we normally use. We flash to the speakers and so on. So we've tried to combine a lot of things that makes it something that someone would want to watch. If you're just having a club meeting where you're just talking, yeah. But what I suggest is you spend a little extra time. And I would say that in the Fair Oaks Club, we're spending a lot more time producing our videos now because our meetings because of the fact that we're trying to engage the audience.
Yeah. Well, and I would say I'm from a little club and we just live stream our Zoom and we put it on Facebook. And we don't have the technology either Roseville or Fair Oaks has yet. But it has made a real difference that people can just come online and we actually have a couple of leaders in our club that are leaders within our community who give updates on what's happening with COVID and where our numbers are and we have to have somebody from the schools. And so we get that report every week and we get a lot of people who come on because they want to hear that report on a weekly basis. And that gives us an opportunity to connect with the community. It also, again, from a little club, we've had speakers who we've been able to line up because they watched us and went, ooh, we'd like to be a part of that. We actually had one of our RYE students from Argentina, or yeah, from Argentina, actually, Lucia liked us on Facebook, and I said to myself, we should have, she could be a speaker in this world. Absolutely. And she came back and spoke to our club after 10 years. And we just had this week, somebody had watched it and said, I'd love to speak about human trafficking. And, you know, obviously that's a big rotary. We were very excited. So they'll be coming in January. And I just think there's so many opportunities if we live stream. And if we're just sitting in our restaurant and nobody knows that we're there, then it's hard to be reaching out to the community. So I fully encourage it. And I also will say, you know, if you're live streaming, make sure your club members don't say something like, man, that other Rotary Club, they're just really. So you just really have, you actually have to spend some time with your members and remind them, guess what? This is live stream.
And
so,
you're on camera and right. You're in a space this big.
Right.
So if you're going to do some, I don't know, hygiene, you might not want to do that right then. Just saying.
Yep. But I think it's just been a tremendous opportunity for Rotary.
Right, absolutely. I totally agree. Now, as part of your workbook, you also have a club review guide. This guide is something, again, it's just another checklist, another thing to spark conversation and spark, you know, what, you know, all the different aspects of a club that make it vibrant. And just ask the question, get responses and things you may have not addressed in a very, very, very long time. So with that, I don't know if we have any more questions there, Beth. We're kind of at the close of the session. So I want to pass along a few thank yous personally. I want to thank Ray for forcing me to do this. You forced me to do a lot of things in my life, Ray. And, you know, this one, it really gave me a chance to kind of work with you. This has been a really great project to work with you on and really kind of get everything out that we've been talking about for years now. And we were able to get it almost all out in one training session, which I thought was great. Mm-hmm. Brent, thank you very much for, you know, basically giving us, again, the security and the safety to do something like this. Again, that goes to show your leadership in saying, you know what, I think this is going to be important. And I know it's a risk, but you know what, I support you guys and let's run with it. And I know that you and Beth were in our writing sessions and we were able to run, you know, after we wrote it, we ran it by you guys and it's like, ooh. Beth is great with expressions. He's like, okay, we'll change that line. How about that? And it was great just getting that feedback from the both of you. Two other big thank yous. I want to thank two of my best friends in Rotary, David Dean and Steve Lemon, for always being here with all the tech stuff and helping us out. Tireless gentlemen. So guys, never in front of the camera, always behind the camera or behind a board, but always there making sure things go well. I want to thank Beth for being our moderator and our question provider and being a great actress in our sessions. She was wonderful. Gentlemen, any final thoughts?
Well, I think that this is a really great start for everybody, and I hope that you feel the same way. You know, again, I hope you don't feel that we were telling you that there's anything that your club needs to do. All we were hoping to do is have you take a good look at your club and find ways that you can strengthen it. And I think that if you do, you'll find things out of this that will help you. Again, the survey is going to be huge because we know that we couldn't cover every possible thing that you might want to know. The survey is going to have a whole bunch of different options of trainings that we're willing to do, and we're willing to get experts in those areas to talk to you about, but we need to know that you want it so we can prioritize and bring those to you. So please fill out the survey. You'll see it later today. And with that, that's my closing comments.
Yeah, guys, I just want to say thank you. I mean, the creativity that you brought to the table, the things that you were willing to say and needed to be said and heard, obviously I can't do it, to allow me to, you know, be an actor. Wow, the risk you guys take.
It was a big risk.
And I think the other thing that's super important is what I'm so proud of is this really is a Rotary thing. I mean, you know, the people you saw in this video, they're Rotarians. They're in your clubs. And I am so proud that they came from all over the district.
Yeah.
This is not just one club. This is lots of clubs came together to help us put this on. And I want to appreciate that you guys were so inclusive in doing that.
Thanks.
And it means a lot.
I'm glad you brought that up because we do all of those people who participated in this video a great debt of thanks. Yep. They spent a lot of time working with us over a weekend when we shot this. You are going to now be able to see all those people because we're going to run some credits for you to show you everybody that participated in this and the Rotary Club. I think you'll be astounded at how many actors were actually in this when you start counting them up and all the different clubs that were involved. So last word, Brent.
Guys, we have vibrant clubs in our district. I just finished visiting all 37 clubs, and I hope that you'll take this to your clubs and they will even be more vibrant when our next governor is there. And remember that we're doing this for the generations that follow us. So thank you all, and please stick in Rotary and make a difference in your community and around the world. Thank you.